See, you're live. All right, what's up, guys? Happy Saturday. Happy Saturday. I was telling before we went, we started streaming. I was telling Dickson about how the post office in the United, like the post offices in the United States, are a piece of crap. I recently went to the post office to send some package via the United States Post Office. Dude, it was terrible, man. They need some funding, man. Like they, I don't know if you guys, how's the post office up in Canada? Do you guys have a pretty good post office?
When they're not on strike, it is.
Yeah, dude, the decor for like their services, it looked like they hadn't been updated since like 1994. And like even like their uniforms, like it was like so crazy. Luckily I had already printed all my labels and stuff to ship out the package. I just when I showed up, I just pretty much set it up there, and then the guy just took it. And he was like, okay, cool. And he didn't actually say anything. There was like no customer service, actually. Now that I think of it, I felt like I was happier than he was to just get the thing. Yeah. I don't think I even got any eye contact. It's pretty crazy, but you know, that's how it goes. How you doing, Dickson? Pretty good.
I'm good, man. Just a busy week. I was telling you, before the stream went live there, like there was a bunch of stuff that's happening this week. Like one of them was mainly, I think you guys may have known from the previous episode, I was looking at getting like corrective eye surgery. And apparently one of the options that people usually get for LASIK, I can't do it because apparently my eyes are so bad that I actually just can't do it. So they have to look at other options, but that should be good. And the upcoming week should be pretty eventful.
Yeah. And in time, there'll be like, based on some of the stuff we've been looking at, like some of the stuff we've been researching, in time there'll be a solution for that too that I think will be applicable to you.
Oh yeah, like maybe just replace the entire eye with some cybernetic like, enhancement.
Yeah, yeah, you're eventually going to be able to get X-ray vision. Let's see.
I already have it, but I mean, I wouldn't mind getting it better.
how's my audio coming in? Is it pretty good? Okay, good, cool. Yeah. Just wanted to make sure. All right. Okay, guys. So to get started today, I am going to be showing off some really cool stuff. I've been telling you guys about this recently in the past or hinting at it in the last couple of videos. Let's see if you guys could see share screen. Should be here. Go right here. Okay, so if you guys go to selftaughthustle.net/signup.html, and it's on the tagline here for my username on the live broadcast. And what I was going to say is, if you're currently struggling with tutorial hell and are stuck and want to learn a strategy for how to break out of tutorial hell so that you can code on your own, go ahead and enter your email here. And again, selftaughthustle.net/signup.html. And I will be giving you or sending you via your email a free strategy for how to break out of tutorial hell. This is a strategy that I apply myself on a regular basis to be able to code on my own. And I have seen that it works miracles with guys so that they could do the same themselves. Okay. So go ahead, add your email here. As well, this is leading up to the promotion for the official educational experience that I am calling Breaking Out of Tutorial Hell. This is a digital course along with some additional perks that I will be revealing to you guys later on in the month that will help you break out of tutorial hell via a hands-on process. Enrollment for this course will start out on July 29th. So be on the lookout for that, especially if you want to get some hands-on educational experience with yours truly, and you want a step-by-step guide for you being able to code on your own. Be on the lookout for that on July 29th. Other than that, from a promotional standpoint, I have all of my links down below. Let me stop. How do I remove this guy here? Other than that, guys, I have all of my Fiverr links down below. If you would like to set up a custom landing page, would like a thumbnail for your YouTube channel, or if you are looking for a technical consultation, I have all of those services down below, as well as if you like to continue support, if you like the free content that we're doing on this channel and you would like to continually support it, I have a PayPal link for donations down in the description box below. Dickson also has, we threw Dickson's Telegram chats, excuse me, his Telegram on the description box below, and then Dickson's YouTube channel down below as well if you want to go ahead and link up with him. Dickson, do you have any promo that you want to do?
Yeah, so basically you could tell that I've changed the name to Vibing with the Future, which is the name of this podcast channel that I'm starting. So if you guys like what we're talking about, you like what I am talking about here, just give me a follow and then I'll be sure to share more information with you guys.
That's awesome. Yeah, we're happy to have you on here, man. These last couple weeks have just been awesome in terms of some of the topics that we've digested. And today what we wanted to focus on is that we want to start to look at something that is called, and I it's kind of like a phenomenon, it like a physical phenomenon, but it's also, it's we'll break into it. We'll look into it more as the video goes in. But we wanted to explore something that's called the Internet of Things, the IoT. If you guys have ever seen it being abbreviated across the web, today we wanted to take a look at exactly what that means and what the implications are in terms of how it relates to humans and people in general. So with that being said, Dickson, go ahead and kick it off, man. What is the Internet of Things?
Sure. So the Internet of Things, like Fido described, it's two different things. It could mean a point in time when there's more devices connected to the Internet than human beings, or it actually means something along the lines of, depending on which definition you find, it could mean like an integration of people, processes, technology, and connected devices that enable more remote monitoring, checking up the status on things, as well as manipulating and evaluating trends using these mm-hmm. devices. So think of something as simple as like a weather sensor, where it's able to go and basically feed you maybe like the airspeed from an airport in a city across the country. And then you're on the other side and you could just basically tell what the speed of the air is, the temperature, the barometric pressure, and things like that.
Yeah. So I like to think about it kind of as like a network in and of itself with a bunch of different devices that collect inputs for that network. Is that correct?
Yep, exactly.
Okay.
That's mainly what it's used for.
Give me one second. I think my audio is like
all good. I'll just keep talking here.
Yeah, go ahead.
And the reason why we kind of picked this topic to start things off is because if you guys remember the previous episode that we did, we went through this huge breakdown of all the different technologies that will lead to the singularity, as per Ray Kurzweil, the chief technology officer of Google, who has had a fantastic 86% accuracy rate in predicting future technologies. And one of the very first pieces of technology predictions that he had come up with, this would have been back in like the 1980s, 1990s, when he came up with this. The first thing on this timeline was about how computers are now embedded everywhere in our environment, whether that's in our furniture, our jewelry, our walls, etc. And when Fido and I were looking at it, we're thinking like, well, you know, we have some examples of things like that, like the, your smartwatch, for example, or your Nest thermostat, if people still use that. Like those would be examples of computers that are now embedded in our environment. But as we looked into it a little bit further, we realized that this really just means it's the Internet of Things. Everything that kind of is encompassed in the Internet of Things would apply to this, because we really do have a lot of computers embedded in our environment now, to the point where we may not even realize that some of the things that we interact with on a daily basis actually has a computer in there.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay. I don't know why I'm not able to hear you through my headphones for some reason. Keep going. Let me figure this out because I'm having some audio issues, guys. Give me a second.
Okay, no problem. So with the Internet of Things, looking into it, I personally didn't know that there was actually so much in regards to it. Looking into it, you start realizing that basically everything that we deal with, like I said, has a computer chip in it. So it could be something as simple as, for example, your lighting, your heating, your air conditioner, security systems and camera system, things like that inside like a smart home. We can already know that there's obviously like a computer chip in there for you to basically get it connected together to the internet and be able to go and monitor it. But there are other things that I didn't realize that actually had a relation to the Internet of Things. So for example, my grandmother, she was in the in an old folks home at one point. And when she was there, one of the things that I remembered seeing was they had these fall sensors that they got all of them to carry around. And all it really looked like, if you guys have never seen one, was it's just like a necklace, basically, with a button on it. And some of them, how it works is, you know, when you fall, some of them can actually detect when someone has fallen and then actually send a signal to whoever they need to notify to make sure that the elderly there is able to get some help. Other ones, it's just like it's a button, you fall and you press it and then it sends help. But little by little, these things are now starting to get interconnected with the internet and other systems to where we're really creating a world that is so interconnected that it's only going to become more and more dense with these connections. Like one of the things that we will go through, hopefully later on in the show, is kind of the future implications of this. Some of the future technologies that will come out of this interconnectedness of all these different devices and sensors. Because one thing that I'm actually really interested in seeing how this turns out is when we start moving towards not just an internet where we can go and share information, videos, pictures, and all that good stuff, but also an internet where we can then start sharing like physical sensations and like sensory stimuli. Like imagine if you're able to go and transfer what the smell of something is like across the internet to another person, or how something feels. Like what would that go and do then with society in general? Like I think one thing that will happen is it will be able to bring people closer together, for better or worse, because there are obviously some negative things that can happen with all this interconnectedness, but a lot of good stuff as well. How's the audio looking, Fido?
It's like you could hear me pretty good, can't you?
Yeah, I can hear you fine. Like there's no problem.
Yeah, the problem is like I can hear you too, but I can't hear you coming in through the headphones, which is super annoying. Fuck. Okay, you know what, I think we're going to have to kill this one.
Okay.
And then give it a restart, okay? Yeah. Or actually, hold on. I'm going to try to leave the studio and see if I could come back, okay?
Okay.
Doing it live, guys. We're doing it live. Okay, I'm going to leave and I'm going to see if...
Okay. So we'll cross our fingers and hopefully this, you know, this works. We'll see what happens when Fido comes back in here. But anyways, let's just go back into the IoT and some of the other technologies that we currently have that would fall into this. So if you just start thinking about all the little devices that you have that connect to the internet, then you start to realize we actually have like quite a bit. Some of the things would be obviously like your Fitbit wristbands. Some of you might have the, it's called Tile, which you could attach to your like keychain or anything that you are concerned with maybe losing. It'll basically track it for you. You have like heart rate monitors and you have like smart beds. You also have like cochlear implants in the ears. How's that looking?
Okay. I think I'm fully back now.
You can hear me fine in your earphones?
Yeah, you're coming through my headphones again. Okay, okay. Yeah, okay, perfect. Yeah, sorry about that, guys. That's what happens when you do this shit live. dude, I love it, man. I love being able to demonstrate mistakes, because y'all, I am the furthest thing from fucking perfect. But yes, okay, so if you could give me like a quick summary of what you talked about in like a couple bullet points.
Yeah, so we talked about how, what are some of the examples of the Internet of Things devices? What are some examples of that people have around their homes? Mm-hmm. And then also just how that's leading to a more interconnected world,
right,
that, you know, for better or worse, will bring people a lot closer in the near future. And the other thing is the development of new technologies, like instead of the current internet we have, to moving towards another version of the internet where now we can transfer things such as like physical sensations or smells over the internet, like that sort of data eventually.
Yeah, that is really crazy. I remember that there was like there was this girl that I was dating back in university. And when she would send me messages, they were loving in nature. And I thought, well, how interesting would it be to be able to actually perceive the emotion that she felt when she sent this message to me via that message? And I think to some regard, we may have kind of like a primitive version of that currently right now. When you think about like your emojis, for example, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. There's like a reflection of the expression that we want to send with like with the message.
Yeah.
And I think that in the future, essentially what you're alluding to there, when two parts of a network communicate with each other, that's just a, like the emoji thing is in the future will just be kind of a more fluid way of communicating that emotion rather than just using an image, a text-based image. It'll be, I don't know. It'll be, at that point, it'll be so integrated that you'll be able to actually feel with the person.
Yeah.
Yeah. The sentiment that the person had in the message that they sent. Right.
Yeah. I think that itself would be, it would do wonders for communication, because right now, a lot of the times we rely on not just the words that we go and, you know, say to each other or send, mm-hmm. send like, you know, through our phones, but also with like the tone of voice, the body language, yeah. You know, the what is it like the you know the micro expressions that people make, things like that. But even that itself is still further away than the actual like sensation that someone's feeling when they are doing something. Like we can maybe empathize, but we won't actually get 100% yet as to what the other person is feeling.
Yeah certainly. And it's actually very crazy, because it seems like these different devices are really just access points for a abstracted network that effectively we can't see in the way that we see it, where if I go outside, I could touch a branch, but I can actually go ahead and interact with that network via the device. And I think the Internet of Things points to that network increasing over time as well, right? I don't know if it directly does it point to like that network growing over time.
Yeah, absolutely. Especially when more and more devices are added to it.
That's the network.
Obviously, that's one thing too that will increase it. But the other thing is who or what is going to be using the internet? Because right now it's usually people or machines, like machines as in like sensors. Okay, like mm-hmm. certain sensors, things that will take sensory data and pass it back to like a server or something like that, or humans actually using it. But sooner or later, when we start actually having like AIs that can automate jobs and such, what will most likely happen is humans being a part of that that network is going to become a smaller portion of it compared to the non-biological or machine intelligences that will be using it. Not that they may not be sentient or anything like that, but like a very narrow AI. They have a very specific job that they need to go and do, and then they're going to be using that network a lot more than we can. Because I mean, obviously, like humans need to, you know, most of us need to like sleep, and like won't be plugged in 24 hours a day. But the machine can just keep running 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. So they'll just keep expanding it and keep using that network way more than we will.
Yeah, that's fascinating. And I think it'll get to a point where essentially the nodes on that network are going to be essentially the amount of nodes that are machines relative to the amount of nodes that are connected to humans will eventually be surpassed. So eventually there's going to be more machines than there are going to be humans on that network. Are we there yet already?
I don't think we're there yet. Actually, no, hold on. We're at a point now where there are more connected devices than there are humans.
Wow.
On the internet. But in terms of like the traffic, I guess you could say that we are there.
Yes.
Yeah. It's only going to get even more pronounced in the coming years.
Yeah. I think that's super profound, because from a human looking in, it's actually come to now a point. It's come to a point now where you interact, your primary form of interaction is through that network, and you're utilizing devices in order to get access to that network in order to communicate with another human. Mm-hmm. And it seems to me that is that's a default in behavior now.
Yeah. Yeah. Or not just to connect to another human. It could be just for a specific goal.
Yeah.
Like I used to have a Fitbit, but I have something else now. Like I use I got the Aura Ring and I like this is an IoT device, but I like to check in with it.
Yeah.
As much as I can, just to look at my, you know, bodily stats, like how was my sleep? How was my, you know, heart rate and things like that. So yeah, I think as time goes on, we're going to see more of those interactions between either trying to connect with other people or just to accomplish a specific goal through those devices.
Yeah. And I think the prevalence and the amount of devices that are connected to the network is also increased by how cheap it is to manufacture those devices. Is that correct?
Yeah. Like, you know, we know of the Raspberry Pi. Mm-hmm. So there's actually there was a Raspberry Pi Zero, which was, I don't know if you've ever seen it, but it's only $15. Dude. Like the Raspberry Pi Zero is only $15.
And Raspberry Pi is only $15?
This one, the Raspberry Pi Zero 2W should be the version. And that one's only, I think, it's like $15 US. And then they have another one, which is called the Raspberry Pi Pico, which is smaller, and that thing is only $4, I think. Like these are computers that you could just program yourself and then almost do whatever, make it do almost whatever you want.
Yeah. That is so crazy. And essentially, one of the things that I was reading from the Singularity is near, or listening to more specifically, is that the reason why this tech has advanced so much too is because the electricity essentially that is being routed in the circuit board has less and less to travel, so it's able to move faster. I'm not a hardware guy. I'm like almost essentially purely software. But is there any truth to that?
Well, yeah, because one thing that you need to be wary of is the resistance from when like electricity is passing. So obviously, the shorter the distance it has to go and travel, the faster it'll be able to go and work. And then the other thing is that, the changes in the material that's made, it will go and make that a lot faster. But you're absolutely correct. The shorter the distance is, the faster it will be, because it doesn't have to travel that far.
Yeah, and I guess in regard to the cost, the reason why we're able to essentially what adds on to the advancement of being able to develop these devices is because if the cost is low in order to be able to develop them, then the ability to produce more of them is viable for the market. That's why we're seeing an increased prevalence of devices being utilized across the network. If you could imagine how costly it was to develop the first computer relative to how costly it is to develop a computer now, it's a day and night difference.
Oh, 100%, dude. Because also with the lowering of the costs, it just makes it so much more accessible.
Yeah.
And what I really like about the whole the DIY kind of community is a lot of the times people in maybe places that are not like a first world country, okay, maybe like a third world country or whatever, the creativity and the ingenuity they have in inventing things is off the charts. Just because they have to be creative with what they have, right? And sometimes they come up with some very interesting solutions and utilizing the same tools or similar tools that we have to do something that, you know, we wouldn't have to think about or we wouldn't have thought of just because we're not in that situation.
Yeah. It is very crazy how the given pressure on of the environment, a lot of times economic, will force people to become innovative and to work with what they have. Mm-hmm. I think one of the what I always thought was so crazy about development and building things in the age of the internet and the information age is that you're essentially accessing the network to get information for how to build for the network. So the network is almost like self-reinforcing in that sense, where the information to work with it and to build into it is contained within the network itself. So you're utilizing the thing, you're learning from the thing that you're building into, which I think is just so crazy, which adds on to the network effect, right?
Mm-hmm. It's like, it's almost like, in a way, it's a living organism. It's like, yeah. Hey, I have all the information that you need to help me grow, but I can't make it happen. You need to go and do it for me. I'll give you the info, but you need to do it for me. So it's almost like we're like the workers that are trying to, build up AI or this, like, you know, this technological entity.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think, the kind of the dream within a dream thing, in the Ray Kurzweil, the audiobook, The Singularity is near, that I was jamming all of today, was they mentioned how, like, they think that the universe, and I forget who he was referencing, because he was referencing another author, that they think that it's effectively, there's a possibility that the universe in and of itself is programmed, so that we're, in some instance, something has, like, programmed us to execute all the functionalities that we're executing, and that the thing that we're developing here with, like, the internet and, like, the growth of these networks is just kind of another versioning of something that we're already living in, effectively.
Yeah.
A dream within a dream.
Yeah, right? Isn't that wild to think about? Because then it's like, you're like, what? So do I really have free will, or am I just programmed to think I have free will and act like I have it, but really it's already been pre-programmed? I just can't see the programming.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Well, and to some extent, I mean, I think there's like our DNA and the things that make us make up a human on a microscopic level have some sort of parallel to them being programmed, which is which is crazy how, like, we, our lifespans biologically, we just live out our DNA sequences, effectively. A lot of the stuff that, a lot of the, like, the health complicate, a lot of the complications that we have with stuff, like, related to health is kind of baked in from day one.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I mean, I think that when it comes to a question of free will, I like to think that we do have free will, you know, for, like, sanity's sake.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, it would be crazy if we are just really living some sort of a program. I think there's I can't remember. There's, like, other scientists that talk about how, like, your perception of reality in and of itself is an illusion, or your ability to best interpret the reality in front of you, but it's not actual factual reality, because it's you're limited to only, like, a handful of senses for you to be able to actually perceive the reality in and of itself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Like, recently I had an experience with something like this, where, like, one of the things that I like to do just for fun once in a while, is, like, looking into, like, astrology stuff. And here's a funny thing, okay? So I think you and I have talked, and we basically there was a time in my life when things were very like challenging. And what I found was that when I was in like a really bad spot, I looked at my astrology stuff like just for fun back then, and I just kind of did it again now. I was like, oh, I wonder if I'm going to see the same thing or see something different. But here's the interesting thing. When I was in a really bad spot in my life and I looked at it, I only saw the terrible stuff, dude. Like, I only saw the terrible shit that popped out from reading that stuff. And then suddenly now the things were a lot better. I changed my beliefs and such. And now I still see some of like the negative stuff, but I saw more of the positive stuff. So yeah, that whole thing about how like we don't really see objective reality is, I think, pretty, at least I saw it very evident in my own life there. That you kind of see it, but at the same time, you also don't see it.
Yeah, yeah. Your
mind colors it a different way.
Yeah, certainly. And it's just so crazy. Because it seemed like computers and humans seem to almost have like a, they almost seem to be like in two different paradigms, where it seems like the human experience is, for better or for worse, and you can agree or disagree with this with the guys in the chat and just in general, but it seems to me that the human experience tends to be some more akin to something where you're consistently evaluating kind of your existential, the existential phenomenon that is life. You know, you're it seems to almost kind of teeter on pseudo spirituality, I would say, like that there's something greater than what you are. It seems like there, I can perceive that, although I don't know if I can tangibly say exactly what it is. We can boil that down to consciousness. Mm-hmm. But computers seem to be different than that. Computers have this like defined one and zeros, right? Everything is a yes or a no, a true or a false. And I guess it's just crazy to me that both of those things exist in parallel, where it seems that human existence is something that tends to be a little more loose relative to how you go about building a computer or how you go about building a program, you know? And I think that's why math is big. That's why physics are big. That's why computer science is big, you know?
Yeah. And I think the other thing is that, because when we look at computers, like for example, let's take a look at like an AI. Okay. Mm-hmm. With kind of where we think it may head, or at least where I think it's going to go. Eventually the AI will be, it could very well become just like a human that never had like a physical form, just only a digital form. It's able to feel, able to think and stuff like that. But to kind of get there, you have those building blocks, those foundational steps that have to be in place in order to basically bring it into reality. But that's very similar to human beings, right? Like we're able to talk and communicate and go create all these like really cool technological advancements. But at the very core, we're just made up of some basic building blocks of like certain like different minerals and materials found in nature. And then when you kind of stack that all up and you start putting it all together, then it just becomes the human being. So kind of like with like AI, is that the computers and everything, it's all very like, you know, very logical, very like very, very structured. But I kind of see the parallel that's almost just like the building blocks of a human, is that everything at the very like lowest level is very like very, very structured. It's like you can't mess around with it, otherwise you're gonna mess up the whole formula. But then as you start getting out of that and it starts being like evolved from there, then things can get a little bit more complex and kind of fluid. But at its very core, it's very strict with what can work and what can't work. Like for a human being, for example, like we need oxygen, okay? It has, like, you need oxygen. You have no oxygen, the human being's not going to survive. It's just like with the computer. It doesn't matter what kind of computer you have, it all needs electricity. Mm-hmm. So you can have like the most advanced thing, you can have the most basic thing, but without electricity, it just won't work. no matter what you try. So I think there's some parallels in there that, yeah, we are kind of building this, maybe we're just programmed to like build an AI or something more advanced than us, and we just don't even know about it.
Yeah. Well, I think one of the things that you, to kind of demystify my point, which I think is really good, is that we're essentially just a layer of building blocks on top of other building blocks, yeah, where you could probably break it down to something as simple as an atom, but those atoms collectively start to add up to cells. Those cells collectively start to add up to you, right? And then it gets to a point where effectively, and I think we hit on this point last week, which is essentially that like consciousness is this like kind of like at the top of the layers of all those like smaller building blocks, right? Mm-hmm. So it seems mysterious to us because we're aware at the highest level of those building blocks, but we are not able to really, we're not even able to consciously trace back to the fact that, oh, actually turns out that we are just a bunch of atoms and shit. But yeah, no, I think that's very true. I mean, I think that it's so powerful that you probably even have some sort of mental connection to that, to those really like incrementals, like small little building blocks, be it atoms or whatever. Because it does seem to me that your thought patterns and the way that you think end up affecting your overall demeanor. And it seems to me that demeanor is probably rooted somewhere at a cellular level. You know,
yeah,
which I think is, then it becomes very, 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 very impactful, because then you start to say, oh, actually, it turns out that I can actually program myself then, mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. You're basically a biological computer.
Yeah. 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 Which is crazy. But yeah, so I guess in regard to like the Internet of Things, I think we're going to see a higher prevalence of electronic devices than we already do now, and then a higher dependency on these electronic devices. Now, what do you think, if we were going to give a worst case scenario, what do you think the negative, kind of the bad news about us being more dependent on these electronic devices will be, Dickson?
There's quite a few. Okay. One of the first things. So in terms of dependence, we'll just be so reliant on the technology that when suddenly, like let's say suddenly, maybe there's like some sort of power outage and we're not able to get the power back on. Okay. When you become so reliant on this technology, people will just become lost without without it. Like, I don't know if this has ever happened to you, but have you ever had like a phantom limb syndrome almost? Have you ever like just forgot your phone somewhere?
Yeah.
You leave the house or whatever, and you're suddenly like, you feel like, oh my God, it's like I'm missing a part of myself.
Yeah. Right?
And like you and me, we kind of grew up with the development of cell phones. Like there was a time when cell phones couldn't even take pictures yet. Like let alone go on the internet. It couldn't even take a picture.
Yeah.
But then now it's gotten to the point where it's so advanced that it literally is a part of a person. But like there are some people that I would not be, I don't think I'd be wrong to say that they're so reliant that you take their cell phone away, like they could have a mental breakdown because it's such a big part of who they are. You know, but if we have these, something like that is kind of like, I wasn't around at that point, but I remember my parents were telling me about something like this.
Yeah. It's like part cell phone, part self-defense weapon, you know, because if any dude tried to jack you, just fucking toss this at his head. That one would be knocked out.
It's a brick. Like you're literally holding a brick and talking to it.
Dude, that's so crazy. This looks like more like something that you'd use to like call in like a jet fighter to drop some bombs.
Yeah, right. Like in Vietnam or like World War II or something. You know, like a satellite phone. It'd be like, hey, I need you to do like an airstrike here.
Yeah, whatever. I mean, look at the thickness. You don't get to see the full extent of it, but look at the thickness of that antenna too. Gosh, man,
dude. So like those things are long too. So could you imagine? You wouldn't even have to hit someone with that phone. You just whip them with the antenna, and that already.
Let alone look at these, man. Holy crap! Oh. Like. Dude, this stuff is like so ancient to me that I would have a hard time just being able to operate
it. I did too. Oh, dude. And my parents used to have this in like the very first house that we lived in. It was in the kitchen. I don't know if you ever saw that, but it was like a phone like that in the kitchen has like the super long cord that you can just pick up the phone and walk anywhere in the kitchen to like talk.
Yeah, yeah. Like the cord, like the springy cord. They look like ramen noodles.
Yeah, yeah.
Dude, yeah. That's so crazy. And this is 1980, so 20, so this is 40 years ago. I would say 40 years ago in terms of relative to how much we've advanced, like 40 years ago is not that long ago for how advanced the phones are now.
No, like you still have people who remembered and used these phones that are still alive today.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's so crazy to me how like advancements in technology normally mean that the technology from a physical standpoint, so like the interface in this case, it would just be like the phone with like these buttons and stuff. Mm-hmm. As time goes on, it gets smaller. Have you noticed that? Like the like physical tech
miniaturizing.
It always goes from like this like fucking huge obnoxious thing to like the most like sleek, small, like tiny thing. Even if you think about like the size of computers in general, like the original computers were like the size of a room, and now I mean I'm talking to you on my MacBook, and a MacBook is literally the size of a real college ruled notebook.
Right.
Which is crazy. And
could you imagine that in the next like couple decades when they really start ramping up nanotechnology, they have like nano sized processors and whatever, where these things are probably like maybe a couple atoms like big, and like you wouldn't even be able to go and see it at all with your naked eye.
Yeah, well, yeah, exactly. Like it would get so small that effectively it would not even be physical anymore.
Yeah, right. It's like at that point, you're like, okay, so is this like magic we're dealing with now?
Yeah, dude. There's this joke that I always had, which was like with the advancements in technology. I was like, bro, if we gave a time machine to Christopher Columbus and we popped Christopher Columbus in 2022. That fool would be freaking out. His head would explode.
Yeah, he'd have a heart attack.
Dude, he would have a heart attack. So it's Christian Soto says, memory is gonna suffer. No real reason to remember anything when you can just look it up. Dude,
yeah,
totally true. That's how you develop software in 2022, man. I literally do not take the time to remember anything just because I know I have the accessibility of a search engine. So there's just no necessity for it. Back in the day, Christian Soto's, I think you're an older millennial. Don't let me date you, but if you can remember, dude, remember how you used to have to remember people's phone number? That shit is crazy.
Yeah,
dude. I remember my mom would be like, "Hey, remember this number in case you get lost or whatever." And then I'd be like, "Okay, like I guess I got to remember this fucking number." And I still have, I remember like a couple numbers for sure because I would just repeat them so often.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, same here. And I think the other thing that's going to, so back to like that whole phantom limb thing, people are going to get so attached to their technology that not only will they just feel lost if, say, there was some sort of blackout or they just don't have access to those, those devices. But I think the other thing that will happen, man, is people won't know how to actually spend their time. For example, when I was a kid, one of the things that people used to go and do all the time is just go outside and literally just play outside, you know?
Yeah.
But with the interconnectedness of, technology and people's lives, it'll get to a point when I think the weird thing is that you might actually have some people who like never go outside, and they'd be perfectly fine. Like they'd be able to live. It's just, it'd be so weird. It's like someone who's just never stepped foot outside of their home or whatever. It'll be like the lockdowns just on steroids.
Yeah. Like, yeah. Well, especially tell me about it. I feel like, that's kind of like the, that's kind of the double-edged sword of being like of development, is that like everything that you do is involved with the network. You know, like if you're building something, if you're talking to a client, if you're working with coworkers, like you're always on the network. And it's so crazy because you're absolutely right. And I think that we're, like I said, I think having the changes that have happened in the last couple of years and the prevalence of the technology to allow us to still be able to connect with one another despite us not being together in the same room has actually, in a lot of ways, defaulted many humans to looking at connecting over the internet as their primary form of communication.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Especially, I think, with like the younger generation, this will probably affect them negatively the most, because you get to a point when, I don't know if you've noticed this, but I've noticed it that with some people where I'm like, am I just noticing this now, or has this always been around? But are there some people who just aren't good? They just can't talk with someone in person anymore. Like they just don't know how to act or how to really interact with people in person because they did so much of it online. And I don't know, maybe it's just an age or generational thing. But to me, I think that's kind of weird. Because the only way we could have interacted with people in the past. And certainly technology has made it a lot easier to go and interact with people now. But at some point, like at least for me, at some point, I still got to get out there and talk to people like face to face, you know? But there are some people who probably would never even think about that. They're like, why? I have the internet, you know, I have Zoom, I have my FaceTime or whatever, or even I have my iMessage or
texting. Yeah. Yeah, precisely. Precisely. Christian Soto says the Razor and Chocolate phones were the shit. Yeah, dude. I remember.
Yeah, they were.
Dude, I remember my mom, I think it was my mom or my sister, bought a pink Razor phone. And I just thought it was like the coolest fucking thing, man. Like I would download like songs on it. I was like, dude, I could download songs on this thing. And then I would play them. I'd be like, yo, I got the Razor. Even though I didn't have the Razor, it was a pink one. It was my mom's.
That's cool, man. See, I didn't do that. Whenever I got my hand on a Razor, me and my friends just pretended we were having like sword fights with it. We're like, ah, it's my Razor.
Yeah, dude. This one for sure, though. The Sidekick. I think we were looking at this, dude. I would like text my little girlfriends with like the Sidekick, bro. And I just thought it was so cool. Yeah, bro, every time I got to flip that freaking screen, man, I was like, damn, I'm in the future, bro. Like,
yeah.
Bro, I might as well have had a time machine in my hands.
Super cool.
But to double back on your point that the lack of social interactivity is like super real, man. It's almost like it's too intense to like look at somebody in the eye and have to like perceive their read their biological their fucking social energy that's in front of you. And I see it everywhere. Like there's just a complete lack of empathetical communication between human beings. Like it's just like people just don't give a shit about interacting with one another in the real world. And to be honest, I think the real world is seemingly dull compared to whatever reality they've been able to create for themselves on the internet, right? Because on the internet, you're not who you really are in your physical reality. You're your Instagram. You're your brand, you're all this other stuff, right? And you get to essentially don a mask of how you want people to perceive you or the image of you. You know what I'm saying? So that is always going to be more alluring than having to come back to reality and being like, oh, like I get to go to the park and I get to go to the grocery store, you know? Like it's just like the network that these devices have led us to become involved in a network that essentially provides us a lifestyle that we're not able to see, like that's not tangible in our own reality, but we get to interact with.
I'm so glad you brought that up, because one thing that I noticed back in like end of 2019, 2020, I don't know if it was like the YouTube algorithm or whatever, but I started noticing this uptick in the VR chat. Have you ever seen that?
No, VR chat, where?
VR chat. So like literally, you just you get your VR goggles and VR chat, I believe, is actual program where let's take a look here. Yeah, VR chat. So it's like an online game, but basically it's a virtual world platform that you go in and you create your own avatars and you can literally go and connect with other people and play different games in there. You can go and talk. You can go and just chill out.
This stuff right here?
Yeah, exactly that. And there, I suddenly just started seeing like more and more videos of that. And then I also realized, I was like, oh my God, there's so many people who are into this. But it's like exactly what you talked about, how in an environment like this, you could literally be whatever you want, which I think is a big part of the appeal. You can literally make yourself look however way you want. You can do almost anything that you want to go and do. And a lot of it basically seems like you have a little bit more freedom versus the real world, which I think is also a big appeal to it.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Especially if you're natively digital, like if you grew up with like a device in your hand, this is like, I don't even find a reason why you would distinguish the difference between the value of being in like reality and like, you know, physical meat space and then being in here, you know?
Yeah, dude. Yeah. Like, who was it? There was a podcast I was listening to. It was the All In podcast. And one of the guys on it, he was talking about how his kids were, because he was kind of from a similar generation where for him, he used to go out and like play outside all the time. Or at least the kids did. But then now, like his own kids, they just spend hours on Discord and like playing Fortnite or whatever. Which, I mean, it's not bad that they go and do that. But it's just like the shift is so apparent from real world to the virtual online world now.
Yeah.
A lot of people.
Yeah, no, I think that's a great point. And I mean, to some extent, I think there is a lot of... there's a lot of things that need to be learned when you're a kid, like getting your ass kicked, like on a playground, or getting in a fight, like stuff like, or getting in trouble, or, you know, like playing on a sport, like playing sports, losing in the sport, like stuff that I think has to do with physical reality that ends up actually helping in your development quite a bit when you grow up, that you're not, you don't necessarily get the same effect, I think, here. If you have like a layer in front of you where you're living kind of like this, like you're in this fantasy realm, and I'm not going to make a moral judgment on that because I think the allure for it is there, you know? And if you go outside, and especially if you're a kid in 2022, you go outside, you're like, you know what? The world is pretty much a piece of shit. Like, why the fuck would I want to like interact with that like pile of garbage?
I think it's that distinction between it being a tool versus like something that's actually a part of you. Not a part of you, but it's like, it's that noticing that distinction that it's a tool, because you and I probably know, like, okay, if we go into like a virtual world, or if we use like Discord or, you know, Telegram or whatever, it's a tool for us to go and communicate with other people. But all the foundational stuff that comes with socializing has to have been there first, right? Like we learn to go and talk with people and interact with them before all this technological stuff, right? Whereas now it's this like, I don't even know how to describe it, but this like virtual world, this all these different tools, this like filter or this layer that is in front of people for when they're interacting with each other. I think one big part of it is that the human mind isn't built for it, I don't think. Like you have to be able to connect with someone like face to face. But like, I think that is something that's just already ingrained in us, just because that's what we had for like so many hundreds of years, right? But then now, if you kind of mess with that, with just hopping into like a virtual world, that's going to impact the development of someone's social skills.
Yeah, substantially. And I think one of the more difficult things too is that the culture doesn't really reinforce you interacting with it. So if you go out to socialize, you're often going to get a lot of people that are very sensitive to social situations just in general. So you end up, so you go out and you interact. You're like, holy shit. Like, I realize that I'm interacting with people who they themselves are in a similar situation where they're not interacting with a lot of human beings as well, you know? Mm-hmm. So I think the incentive to do so is not really, it's not really reinforced. In fact, I think it's more likely that what's being reinforced is a tendency for separation.
Yeah, I think so too.
For better or for worse. I mean, I'm saying that as objectively as possible. I'm really not trying to cast a morality on it. It's just, mm-hmm. it's just an observation that I notice.
Yeah, like I'm not saying it's bad either, because I totally get where you're coming from. I use these tools quite a bit myself, because I have friends on the other side of the world, which I wouldn't be able to keep in touch with them if there wasn't something like this. So I guess it's more of a tool. It's not really good or bad end of the day.
Yeah.
It's just how you go and use it and what's your relationship with it.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that's one of the key things that I've been learning a lot from in this series, is that there are tools and then there are the implications of when those tools go and get applied and get implemented, like a computer, like your phone, so on and so forth, the outcome of the implementation of that tool has more to do with the behavior of the human that's using the tool than the actual tool itself, right? Mm-hmm. And I think so often it just gets so that there's a lot of confusion, and we blame the tool, and we don't realize that a lot of it's the tools kind of just play to our to our deficiencies as human beings, or to our I wouldn't say necessarily deficiencies, but kind of our qualities as human beings, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
What's a VTuber? Do you know what a VTuber is,
Christian? Oh, yes. I know exactly what Christian is talking about. Have I seen some? Yes. Have I watched their entire streams? No, I don't have the time for that, but I have seen some clips. So this VTubers? Stuff? Yeah, dude. So basically, they are real people. The one that actually, if you zoom out of here, I'll show you the one that really started to bring it up. No, go back to the images. And then right there. You see the girl with the pink like bow tie thing? So
right here?
Right there. So it's a huge thing in Japan. And so I believe this is Kizuna Ai is the name. And she was basically supposedly like an AI, okay? But really it's a girl. If anybody who likes her watching this, I'm sorry to burst her bubble, but it's more likely just a person wearing a motion capture suit and then just like acting things out. Okay? But I mean, hey, whatever, just believe what you want. But these are VTubers. So it's like virtual YouTubers where they stream video games, talk, like sing, do all like the other, YouTuber stuff. But it's not the actual person that you see. It's this avatar. And it is insane how much it's blown up this year. So I'll tell you one. In Japan, one of the very popular ones is it's called HoloLive. So you see that? Yeah, that shark girl right here. So she is actually one of the most popular ones on the internet right now. Like one of the most popular ones, to the point where get this. Okay, so you remember Comic-Con when they used mm-hmm. to have like actors and everything go and do panels or whatever?
Yeah,
at the different anime cons or these different conventions, they actually have VTubers join it now. But remember, they're virtual, so it's not the actual person that's like doing it there. It's the avatar projected onto a screen, and they actually interact with the fans through that.
Well.
And I'm glad that Christian brought this up, because this is something that I wanted to go and talk about. I didn't know when we were be able to talk about this, but there's a book by Max Tegmark, which I think I mentioned to you before, which is, it's called Life 3.0. Max Tegmark is the professor of physics in MIT. And one of the other things that he is also well known for is his work around AI and also kind of thinking into the future the different versions of AI that may come out. You've got like the Skynet, the Utopian, and like all the other ones like in between. But one of the things he talks about in that book was about, which I see this as being a step towards. One of the things he talks about in the book was about how in AI eventually will be able to create, it'll be able to create virtual humans, okay, like humans or virtual people that only exist in the digital form, but they will be indistinguishable from you or I. You will be able to, like, but they only exist in the virtual world.
It's now, like, it's like the girlfriend from, what's his name? Ryan Gosling in Blade Runner.
Yeah. Yeah. But here's why I say this is a step towards it, because right now these are still people that are behind that, that avatar.
Okay? Yeah.
The camera's just doing the motion capture, and then the avatar just, like, you know, animates the expressions and everything. Oh, sorry. The expressions are then animated onto the avatar. Now, imagine when it gets to the point where it's no longer a person behind it.
It's all programmed.
It's an actual, like, AI that is acting crazy there. And I think this is a step towards it, because a lot of these VTubers, they obviously make a point not to show their real faces, just because, like, you know, some people just, they don't want to know the real person behind it. They want to be able to project onto this. Not that that's bad, because I'm not gonna lie, some of them are actually very entertaining. Some of the shit they get up to is hilarious.
Yeah. But
yeah, this is a step towards that future where eventually I think we will have digital humans. And here's the other thing, man, is eventually we're gonna, this will be very interesting to see, because right now we have actors, actresses, movie stars and stuff like that. What's going to happen when we start having digital humans that can do the same job, if not better, and do shit on in like film and video games or whatever that a normal human just may not be able to go and do? Like, what's the world going to be like now? Will we even have anything like the Oscars anymore? Will we even have any of the fascination we have with movie stars like we do, or would it change?
Yeah, we'd start, like worshiping the AI version of these VTubers.
Right. But like, it'd be such a strange and weird future at that point. Like, people would like fall in love with like an actor or actress, and then you find out that, hey, this actor and actress is actually a digital person. They don't exist in the real world.
Yeah.
They exist on the screen only, but you can't tell the difference
at all. Especially if you could get a personalized experience with the VTuber, and it's like fully AI, like it's a full AI, and it like can, it's essentially, its goal is to like be your best friend, you know?
Well, that's the other thing is in that same book, he talks about, it's actually the very beginning, about this AI that, it was a thought experiment that he came up, and the AI is called Prometheus. And that's one of the things is that eventually at like first it finds out how to go and make money. Okay, how does it go and do that? And then eventually it starts to create a bunch of this content by itself with like digital humans, but it's able to go and create it at such a fast speed and at such a low cost that literally any person alive would then be able to get their own customized content just for them, just for their tastes. So imagine you have like that, like a digital actor or actress.
Yeah. But
now it's in customized content just for you.
Dude, like, that's so crazy. Yeah, exactly. That's so crazy. Cause then you could get like, there's like those things where you'd be like, man, sometimes it'd be so cool if I just had like if you ever say anything like super kind to yourself, mm-hmm. and it feels really good. And it would also feel extra good if you get like something like one of these like VTubers to be custom to essentially your necessities and your preferences, and then it be like uplifting, you know?
Yeah.
To be like, if you're having like a tough day, to have it like follow you around and be like, hey man, like what's wrong? Like, don't worry about it. Like, it's all going to be good. What if you had like a brutally honest one that would probably be, dude, that would be the best one that, you know, oh, let me get back on screen. I'm not even on screen. But like, what if you had like a brutally honest one and he was like, hey man, you're fucking up. put that cheeseburger down, motherfucker. You know?
Dude.
I would get that one. You just had to be stern but fair. Stern but fair, you know?
Oh dude, you that thing would be a thing. Cause in Japan, okay. do you ever watch anime? Do you watch any anime or anything like that?
Yeah, not like most recently, no. But I have some anime exposure. Yeah.
Okay. Have you ever heard of the term called a tsundere?
Tsundere.
Okay. The T-S-U-N-D-E-R-E. So usually it's like an anime trope where it's like a guy or a girl where they're like uncomfortable with their feelings, especially like their feelings of love towards like the main character. So they always act like an ass towards them, but secretly deep down, they're like, oh no, I really love this person, but I just, you know, can't express myself properly. So like, they'll be really mean to that person that they love. Yeah. So
that's like it's like Helga from Hey Arnold. Did you ever watch Hey Arnold?
Yeah. No, that's exactly it. Yeah. That, okay. Helga from Hey Arnold. Yeah. That's like that. So in Japan, okay, I'm quite certain because I remembered when I went there, I didn't go here. Okay. Just a FYI, but I know that when I just took a jaunt through Tokyo, whatever your thing is, you'll find it. And one of the things they have, which I cannot confirm or deny, okay, but I am quite certain that they have like a cafe where the girls actually are mean to you, like Helen. and people pay good money to go there.
Good God, I could not do that. That's terrible. But that's funny. If it's your kink, you know.
I mean, hey, they have cuddle clubs there, man.
Oh, so, there you go, dude.
They found a way to basically commoditize human emotions. So I would I mean, hey, like, respect the hustle, right?
Yeah, respect facts, man. Christian Soto says, Iron Man's Jarvis and Friday?
Yeah, so, you know, the AI that...
Jarvis, yeah. That they have that in the U.S. Christian Soto says that they have that in the U.S. Where you go to the cafe to get your ass whooped by somebody else. That's funny, you know, man.
Yeah, it's hilarious. So anyways, just kind of going back to like the digital human stuff, like whatever your thing is, eventually it'll get to the point where it can be completely tailored towards you and what would make you the happiest.
Yeah. And
that would be the best thing. Yeah.
And that's Dickson, I interrupted you. Go ahead, man.
No, I was just going to say that it's...
Dick's last resort. Dick's
last resort. I was going to say that it's good, but it can also be bad when people become just over-reliant on like the digital humans, okay? Or when this actually becomes a thing. Mm-hmm. Because... one thing that I didn't even realize this until I think within the last couple of years, but if people start getting more and more attached to these like digital avatars, like they are helpful. They are a tool that can help people. But the concern is, what if you just wind up getting so attached to it that you don't form human connections anymore, like actual physical human connections?
Yeah.
And then eventually, like, we already know that there's like plummeting like birth rates in different countries around the world. Like, what happens when suddenly we have like a negative or like a population, I forget what it was called, but basically like we don't have enough people being born, that we have a smaller population that's on the planet, and we have a population decline that's happening. I think that it's going to be one of the bad things that'll happen, because some people might just, you know, feel that they get everything fulfilled by this like digital avatar, that they no longer need to go out and actually interact with humans.
Yeah. I mean, I can see, I'm starting to pick up on some of that even now. Like, I think that the early onset of that is happening now. And I actually think that we're probably if I'm thinking about it, this like two to three steps ahead, I think that there's probably going to be some form of a kind of a counter effect to this, where there's going to be enough people who haven't essentially that I feel like everybody's just really craving to connect with one another. Like, underlying all of this stuff, we could get as many devices as we want. We can connect to the internet. We could do all this stuff, but we can't change our underlying biology. And I think that that biology is almost it's almost like it's swelling. Like, the necessity to want to connect with one another is increasing. So Will it last forever? I don't know, but I do think that there's going to be some sort of maybe just like a temporary reversal in which you'll see a lot of increasing human interaction.
In the future, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, because the urge to do so is just getting to a point where people want to interact with one another. You know, people want to have meaningful connections. They want to be able to experience, like, unconsciously. I mean, it's inherent in humans that we want to make these organic networks with each other. And I don't think I think it'll be like a phase where we start coming back together and we really enjoy interacting with each other. And then we forget why we ended up doing that in the first place. And the reason why is because we had become so disconnected. And when we forget that, we start getting back out into these artificial networks and becoming more involved with them again, you know? Mm-hmm. But I think people who are conscious right now are aware that it is a problem that we don't have connectivity to that degree anymore, and that there's probably something inherent in most people that says, hey, look, I actually want to go and connect with people, and that's a part of me, you know?
Yeah, totally. Like I think both of us have gone through, you know, something like I'm about to describe is we could just get into work mode so hard sometimes that we forget.
Yeah,
that we're like, hey, you gotta take a break and actually like reach out to people, you know, because there's more to life than just work. But there's been times I know in my own life that I forgot about that, and it was just work, and then you just wake up at one point and you're like, man, why do I feel alone? Okay, why do I have this like very uncomfortable feeling inside? And then you just realize like, oh, well, maybe it's because the last time I actually, you know, hung out with my friends was like 6 months ago. And then you realize, like, hey, that's a big problem, you know?
Yeah.
It's just being aware of that. Because I think sometimes you just fall asleep at the wheel or in certain things like that. Or something else is going on that made it so that you didn't even want to be aware of that.
Yeah. That's such a good point. And it becomes kind of easy to sacrifice in the moment. And because you're so inundated with information coming at you at like all at once, it's just so much easier to just be like, nah, I'll just knock it for today, and then I'm gonna go back and like do my work. But yeah, no, you're absolutely right. And I think to some extent it'll be necessary for innovation to continue to prosper, for us to continue to make those connections, because I think it's in making those human connections and in those real human connections that you get ideas for new things, for solutions, for problems, you know. And it's not clear to me that just being stuck, you know, communicating with people via a network is actually leading to is giving us the full spectrum of ideas that we could have otherwise if we were actually be able to communicate with people on a first person basis. Because I realized that there's thought patterns kind of go in, kind of exist in this contraction, a release and contraction, where if you're focused on solving a particular problem, there's this like extreme contraction into your mind where you're trying to focus on getting this like fucking little piece of code to work, right? Mm-hmm. But sometimes you don't get the full, you're not able to actually solve the problem because you're so focused on it, and just so your brain has become so contracted in trying to get this thing to solve that it doesn't even solve until you go out and you walk around the block and you actually allow your brain to release all of that logical tension. Mm-hmm. And it's only when you do that that you open up your mind, and that your mind like physically opens, and the solution will come out of nowhere, you know? Yeah. And I think that I think it's absolutely important to have both of those balances. And I'll be the first one to tell you that I make that sacrifice all the time of being like, you know what, like fuck like going and doing something, just doing something that's just a casual, like hanging out with like friends and stuff, because I have like stuff to get done. Mm-hmm. And that's a very difficult line to walk too, because I feel like a lot of the guys in our community feel like a lot of stuff is popping off, you know, in the world. And for me, I think one of the things that I get affected by is like, hey, you know what? I'm not really in a mood to celebrate, you know, mm-hmm. at least that's the thing I tell myself. And not that every social interaction is like a celebration, but I'm like, you know, there's so many problems right now going on with the world that I feel like it's necessary for me to be of contribution to the world, to start like looking for solutions, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think that obsession can get the best of me sometimes, for sure.
Yeah.
100%.
It's a balancing act. Like it's a big balancing act from what I found, because it's not like you should give up, you know, working on your purpose or anything like that, just to spend all your time with your friends. That's not going to be healthy either.
Right.
But at the same time, you don't want to go and neglect that human connection either.
Yeah,
exactly. You can only go so long without it. I mean, unless you're like a psychopath or something like that, then hey, you know, at that point, it doesn't really matter. But
yeah,
I think, yeah, it is that balancing act. And I guess for myself, one of the things that I kind of, what I do to kind of remind myself is, yeah, you're working towards something, or the world is bad, okay? Or like there's bad things happening in the world. But one thing that I try to get myself to remember is it's not always going to be bad, okay?
Yeah, it's like a season.
Yeah, it's a season, yeah. It's not always going to be bad. And whatever you're working on, you will eventually, you know, achieve it. But when you achieve it and you want to go and celebrate, I mean, I know for myself, I'd want to go and share that with some of the people that I care about.
Yeah. Yeah. Right?
Because wouldn't it suck if you work so hard trying to, you know, build business, work on this book, or just something that you really care about,
and have nobody to share it with.
Exactly. And then have nobody to share it with when finally you've achieved it, or when like things aren't bad anymore and you have the good times, wouldn't you want to go and also like share that with some other people too?
Yeah, exactly.
That's at least what I go through in my mind, because I have gone through times in my life when I really neglected it, and then suddenly I was hit in the face where I was like, wait, this sucks. Like I did all this, but now I don't really have a life anymore, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Man, yeah, you hit on so many points there. And I think, yeah, I mean, when you go out and you embark on like this journey of something that you're going to accomplish, like so much of like the victory lap, if you will, of once you kind of cross that that boundary of whatever goal you're trying to get for. And I'm kind of speaking generalities here, mm-hmm. if you guys don't mind. But what I was going to say is that when you get across that line, like I've noticed so much in me that like what I end up the vision ends up being like me getting across that line and always like being able to share that with like people, you know, like the people that I love. And so much of what I do, I think, is tied down to that, is showing people that this stuff is possible, and that like you don't have to, that you could keep fighting and you can keep making things work. And sometimes I think it's just easy to get lost in the sauce and forget that's the point of why I'm even doing this in the first place.
Yeah.
And to connect this back to like the Internet of Things, I think it just, you're as a human, you could get, your mind could just get shredded through all of this information that gets thrown at you, through all these different devices that you're interacting with. I mean, if I'm like breaking down essentially the setup for this broadcast, I have multiple different, I have at least three, four, I have four different devices, five if you consider this this lighting fixture, devices activated right now to be able to broadcast right now, you know. And it's just crazy. I mean, like to some extent, I think like I've adapted to it to a point where it seems like it seems kind of like normal. But if I think about it, growing up, like when I was a kid, like thinking about utilizing so many devices was just completely abnormal to me. Like I would get outside and I would play in the dirt and I'd go interact with other kids. And I think that's why, I think millennials are kind of unique in that regard, that they kind of got the that two-sidedness of things, where they remember, if you knew just for a few years what life was like before, like all of this, we started to see these like large exponential gains in technology, and we see life now afterward. Right. And because of that, you kind of get that split between, and that's probably why you and me are able to talk about the necessity for that communal connection in the first place, Dickson, is because we probably, I'm going to assume we remember, you also remember a time where shit wasn't so like, we weren't so plugged in, if you will.
Yeah. Like I remembered my first cell phone was when I was, I think I was 12. Yeah, I was 12. Mm-hmm. And this thing, dude, all it did was just call and text. And text, it was only like you had to pay for text. So I remember that it was only for emergencies. And when I was traveling anywhere, walking around, I actually had to like pay attention to all the stuff that was going on. I wasn't glued to my phone anymore. And when you talk to people, you always met up with them or maybe call them on the phone, but more than likely you would meet up with them. Whereas now it's, that's almost in a way, it could also seem weird, you know, like some people think it's like weird to actually like speak with someone on the phone versus just text. And I'm like,
yeah,
that's, I'm like, what? Like, well, that's weird.
Yeah. If you ever like, if you ever like hang out with like girls that are like a generation, like your legal Gen Zers.
Yeah.
What I was going to say is, they're like, if you call them, they're like, what the fuck? Like, holy shit.
Yeah.
Like, whole, like human interaction. But yeah, no, I think one of the things that I was, that I was thinking about too is that the cause out, like there was this like kind of serendipitous nature to social interaction, even for most of like my 20s, where it seemed that the social networks that I was involved with were physical enough where I could like casually run into somebody who I hadn't seen in a while and we could like strike up a conversation, you know? Yeah. And it seemed like once I like you know, like you'd either be at the store or between classes or stuff like that. And I think obviously because you're in a given physical environment at that point. Mm-hmm. But a lot of that I think carrying into like into my later 20s pretty much disappeared. Like everything, like if you're interacting with somebody in your legit adulthood, it's because you want to be there, you know. A lot of times there's not a lot of casualness to the chances of you meeting up with somebody, right? It's not like you could just go to the grocery store and you'll like run into somebody that you know, and then you'll like talk and you'll go and like you'll get a coffee. Like, I mean, I could be wrong, it just does not seem like that type of social interaction is very typical in the United States in 2022.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I think another thing is that once you know cross into that threshold of being an adult, you also have like time constraints now. You have other priorities too. Whereas before, we may have had a lot of time that allowed us to go and do that.
Yeah.
But yeah, you're absolutely right.
That's a good point.
I found that the other thing though is that, you know, besides the constraints and priorities, is just through maturity. You start to realize like you only want to spend time with the people that you actually really care about. It's no longer like, oh, who gets to, you know, have the most like Facebook friends, or who has like, who knows the most people or has the most acquaintances. At least not for some of the people that, you know, that I know, like yourself or people that I hang out with or stuff like that. A lot of the times it really comes down to like, who are like the quality people that you want to go and spend time with. And a lot of the times that just leads to your circle being a lot smaller. But I think it's a lot more gratifying than having a large circle, but yet it's all very like shallow, which it was like for me, at least when I was in school.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And I think, yeah, man, it's just, that's a really good point. I think, let's look at it on the other side. I think that being reliant on networks and devices for business purposes, for getting stuff done, has increased our productivity and is ultimately, I think, part of the reason why we're going to be leading into faster and faster innovations, is because we're just able to complete things in a lot faster of a way. Like, totally. the necessity to like have to go and physically use your hands to go and accomplish something of value to the market in 2022 is not necessarily even there anymore, unless you're working with some sort of hard skill related to if you're like a lineman, if you're like a plumber, they have to use you for like reasons that are necessary for human survival. That is, I would say that's like the one large exception there. But for a lot of other stuff, like all the stuff gets done on the internet. Everything gets done through a device. A lot of stuff like communications for things to be executed on get done through chats. You know what I'm saying? So if you're trying to get stuff done, it's all on in these networks. So you're almost like forcibly having to feed into it to be able to have a productive output on to the market and onto the economy. So it ends up kind of being this self-fulfilling prophecy in some regard, right? Because the more, like I told you, it's like the more you get involved with the networks, the more you add on to the networks, especially as a developer, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm actually really glad you brought that up, because speaking about like jobs and also how IoT really influences it, is we're going to start getting more and more jobs that used to be done. I think we're going to get more and more jobs that used to be done, like you had to be physically there. A lot more of it is not only going to be automated, but I think it's also going to get to the point where someone can remotely go and do it, maybe through like some sort of connection with a robot and VR.
Yeah, you had mentioned this last time.
Yeah, like in some of the convenience stores in Japan, we're probably going to see more and more like that, where we will still need, you know, someone or something there physically to do the job, but then the person controlling it doesn't have to be physically in the same space. They could be like hundreds or thousands of kilometers away, but just because of the interconnectedness of the internet with those devices and objects, they're able to go and still complete their work.
Yeah, exactly. Let alone, I think that if technology gets to a point where it's more easy to manufacture a robot to accomplish a particular task than it is to hire a person, that is when that individual, that human, gets displaced effectively.
Yeah.
Now, that sounds kind of negative, but I really think that what it also does is that it, give me 1 second, sorry about that. Yeah. Is that it enables that person who got displaced to focus their mind on developing another set of skills that may be more relevant to the market, right? Whereas to before, maybe that person would have been contained, like I do not mean this in a demeaning way, but just as an objective analysis, like maybe that person was constrained to just being a trucker, right? Mm-hmm. So that the development for a machine that's able to do a trucker's tasks becomes cheaper than actually hiring that trucker. That trucker would then get displaced. Well, if the trucker gets displaced, then the likelihood that he'll have to learn another skill in order for him to survive in the market is very, very high. And at that point, the only skills that will be available will be just things that technology hasn't been able to displace yet, which usually means that they'll likely be more of an advanced skill set, you know? So that's, I think that's a spin on it that that kind of gets overlooked.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think the other thing is, aside from also those advanced skills, is it's also going to open up new opportunities too. There will be like new opportunities, new jobs that I think will be created through this automation, because now we can go and put our focus, just like you said, somewhere else that is much more needed.
Yeah, exactly. And we're going to, and it all kind of contributes to more advancement, because if you have humans that are focused on more specialized set of skills that at that point will likely be more technology intensive and more advanced, then they're inherently going to be building and innovating at a higher level than the humans before them, which means that they're contributing to the increment of the technology, which is contributing to the exponential growth of everything, which is contributing eventually to the singularity. So we're like, it's just, everything is just kind of adding, like compiling onto itself in that regard.
Yeah, absolutely. It's just compounding on top of each other with every step of the way, every iteration that this goes through.
Yeah. It's just compounding on top of it. Yeah, exactly. And yeah. And I think that's, I mean, in a lot of ways that's good, man. I mean, I think it just gets so easy spun off as like the AI is just going to come and it's just going to kill us all.
Yeah. It's easy. It's
in a video game.
It's, you know, fear mongering, I think, is the other thing. But not saying that it can't happen, because there is, you know, dangers that can come from that, but that's not the only thing. Okay. I think it's just so easy to focus on the negative thing, just because, you know, as human beings, we focus on the negative things pretty easily, I think, compared to focusing on more positive things.
Positive things. Yeah, exactly. And I think that there's going to be a lot of innovation that ends up benefiting us throughout a lot of periods in up until the point. I mean, we'll see what happens if like when that AI becomes sentient. But for example, like if you think about the conveniences that you get with Amazon or you get with Uber, right? Like in the short term, those are awesome conveniences that honestly, like we completely take for granted. We completely like so many of the conveniences that technology has given us. It's just so easy to be like, okay, like that's just like the way the world is. But the reality is no, that's not the way that the world once was. You know, you weren't able to just like get a book on Amazon and then have it delivered to your door in the next day. You know, with that amount of speed, you weren't able to just order any food from any like distributor across your town unless they did delivery. You know what I'm saying? So like all of those conveniences, like they have tremendous amount of benefit for us, you know. And I think and in fact that's partially why you've seen such a large displacement even in the population today, you know. It's because there's so many things have just become automated. There's just automations for everything now. You know, and it's so crazy because we think about the future ahead, and it's sometimes I look around and I'm like, dude, some of this stuff is already like it's pretty much already here, you know?
Yeah, dude. Yeah, totally. Like some of it, I mean, like when I was a kid, okay, I remembered when you like ordering something online wasn't a thing. I remember having to get like a catalog and actually mailing it in so that you can go and get something sent to you. Whereas now it's like, hey, I'll just go onto Amazon and the next day, whatever I ordered is right on my doorstep.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And no, I think that there's going to be a double-edged sword with a lot of this stuff.
Like one thing I wanted to bring up was with like the Internet of Things and how that's going to advance in the coming decades. One of the other things that I wound up reading recently, very interesting, was have you ever heard of zero energy devices?
No.
Okay. So you know how with the Internet of Things, a big part of it is just all these different sensors that we have out in the world that collects a whole bunch of different data that we can, you know, use to do a lot of things, take action on or use for research or whatever. Mm-hmm. But zero energy but a lot of those sensors and devices still need energy. Like they still need like some sort of electrical power to power it up. And unfortunately, some of them, if they run on battery, you have to get somebody out there to change the battery. Otherwise it stops working. Right. Mm-hmm. But actually I'll send you something here in the other chat here. So this is actually an article from Ericsson. So Ericsson is a corporation from Sweden, a telecommunications company. They are one of the leaders in 5G. And they are credited with creating the Bluetooth technology. Now, zero energy devices is basically devices that you don't need to have. It's not technically zero energy. What it really means is that you can get energy to power up that device from its surroundings. So it could be from like vibrations, light, temperature, radio frequencies, stuff like that. So So one of the good things about it is imagine you have, say, like a heart rate monitor, okay, or something that monitors your body in case of a heart attack. If they implant something into your body, okay, right now they more than likely would have to have some sort of a battery attached to it, and you have to go and get surgery and then get it replaced or whatever. But for this, imagine having a device that's zero energy, where you implant it once and then it uses your body heat in order to power it.
Wow.
Then you could just keep it running forever. But it can also be used for obviously negative stuff, because imagine you have some sort of like surveillance bug that all it has to do is use light or just like light or heat or residual like electrical energy from like a lamp in a house or something like that. And all you got to do is just put it there and it just winds up recording and transmitting forever, as long as there's a source of energy nearby.
Yeah. It says, and then just to piggyback off of what Dickson says, the official definition is that enter the era of zero energy devices that from the end user's perspective operate without a battery. Instead, the energy necessary for communication is harvested from the surroundings, from vibrations, from light, from temperature gradients, or even from the radio frequency waves themselves. Yeah.
Yeah. And actually the next paragraph there piggybacks on when you were talking about like Amazon and ordering things, because it's talking here how imagine you could actually print these zero energy devices on boxes. So now you can not only track things there, but you could even use it to measure, for example, like temperature inside. If let's say you're mailing something that is sensitive to your temperature, you can keep monitor on it.
That's crazy. That is absolutely nuts. Monitoring the environment is another. Yeah, so it says packages in a warehouse can be tracked by using low-cost, zero-energy devices potentially printed directly on the boxes. Crazy. This could work even if the box is behind other boxes, avoiding the use of optical barcodes. The box may even provide information on, for example, temperature or humidity in the box, something which is not possible with a passive barcode. Monitoring the environment is another scenario where miniaturized, low-cost, zero-energy devices could play a role. Monitoring the environment, that is super crazy.
Yeah,
they'll probably end up having some sort of integration with like the foglets that we were talking about last time.
Totally, dude. Like with something like this, I think it's only going to speed us up on that timeline to getting to the point where physical reality and virtual reality just gets blurred.
Yeah,
yeah, and also this will also increase the interconnectivity of the Internet of Things, because if you could start deploying devices that no longer needs to have a battery and they just collect energy from its surroundings, you could just keep, if you could theoretically keep churning things out and throwing it everywhere to the point where like the entire world is almost littered with this stuff.
Yeah, I mean, true. Good or bad. Holy shit. That's such a good point. It would almost necessitate it then, because the thing with the battery at its most simple is that it has a period in which it's energized, so it's able to contribute to the functionality of whatever it's installed in, but it will eventually run out of energy. Therefore, you're going to have to get to some point where you recharge that thing, right?
Yeah.
But with this, you never have to recharge.
Yeah, you never have to. As long as it could keep collecting energy from its surroundings, then it just keeps working forever. Or until it like breaks down.
That's so crazy.
Or whatever, yeah.
Dude, that is so crazy. Yeah, I mean, and by that time, dude, imagine the, if you want to go back to the Internet of Things, by that time, the, man, because especially if it had some sort of connectivity to the network too, I mean, the amount of devices, that'll get to a point where you were mentioning at the beginning of the chat where like the amount of devices relative to the amount of human beings is just going to be overwhelming. Like the network is going to be bigger than,
it just dwarfs like humans in general in us interacting with it. And here's the other thing is, could you imagine the data draw that comes through that? The amount of data that will be flowing through the internet,
yeah,
based off these devices, like it would be like, it's just mind blowing how much they will be able to go and pull from the environment, from the real world.
That's so crazy, man. Dude, do you remember there was that Turkish guy, speaking of data draw, this guy, Turkish artist, data murals, this dude.
Ooh, yeah.
So we'll do, he does, I don't know if it's going to be, man.
Was it Rafik or something like that?
Yeah, it was something like that. Turkish Rafik. Do you remember how to spell it, Dickson?
R-E-F-I-K space, and the last name is Anadol. I hope I'm pronouncing that correct. It's A-N-A-D-O-L.
I feel like you gave it to me and I still mispronounce it. All right, let me see images. Yeah, dude, this dude. So he does some sort of like machine learning algorithms to essentially interpret data from like, I don't know, whatever selective input. It could be like, you know, like the sounds of like a rainforest or something like that. And he like will essentially have these algorithms interpret that incoming data and then process it out into a moving mural effectively. So stuff like this. Yeah, this shit is just absolutely bonkers to me.
Like I think it's just so beautiful because it's a mix of, you're mixing the real world with technology and then be able to generate something completely new.
Yeah, precisely. I mean, and if you want to tie this back to the Internet of Things, all these inputs are collected from some sort of device somewhere, somehow, you know?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. It's collected somewhere in the world.
That, I guess, and that's the way that I kind of think about it relative to like the devices and like the role that they play, is that they're kind of like an access point for the network, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, that is a very good way to go and put it.
Just so crazy to me, man.
Yeah,
She's like, what the fuck?
Well, I remember when I first saw it, I was like that. I was like, what am I looking at? Like, what is this thing?
Yeah, it's absolutely bonkers, man. No, I think it's really, really cool. Makes me, I love how it's like a combination of both art and technology kind of hitting you at once.
Yeah.
I think he ended up making, I wonder if he ended up making, let's see if this we get a play of this. Yeah, this stuff is crazy. He's like, oh, dude, take that, Jackson Pollock.
Yeah, it's like, you got Jackson Pollock, but then you got this guy.
Yeah, yeah. No, dude, this is absolutely nuts. Absolutely nuts.
Yeah. Just
so amazing.
And that's the other thing is, like, with all the newer, like the new, I don't know what you would call, like, new additions, I'd say, or mm-hmm. enhancements to the Internet of Things, we're going to see more and more things like this, if not even, like, maybe weirder and cooler, that's just going to spring up from it. Because without the Internet of Things, this wouldn't have happened. There's no way you could have done something like this.
Imagine these being... Dickson, sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, it's okay. You go ahead. You go ahead.
I was going to say, imagine these being foglets, bro, and then you can, like, touch the painting, and then it starts, like... crawling over your skin, bro.
Oh yeah, dude. So actually that actually ties back to the other thing I was talking about was, imagine when we start having the internet where you could transfer sensory information across it. Like, you could actually create sensory information and let someone feel it, like what it's like to touch something like that.
Crazy. Yeah, dude, it's all kind of, that totally makes sense. And it would be crazy too, because I could actually also see those foglets. You could probably have them construct like some form of like modern armor over you too, as well, right?
Yeah. Yeah, totally, dude.
And you could have it like that. They'll probably be able to read off different like, different aspects of your biology, like your temperature, like your heartbeat, all this stuff, and just kind of essentially have this like adaptive skin being created by these foglets that protects you from physical harm.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. There was one actually, because when you mentioned that reminded me of this one game that I played.
Crisis?
No, but that is one of them. That wasn't what I was thinking of. That wasn't okay. What I was thinking of. We can talk about that in a bit though. I was thinking of Deus Ex.
Deus Ex.
Yeah. So search up. Okay. It's called the rhinodermal armor.
Rhinodermal.
Actually, here, I'll type it to you. Give me 1 second there. Rhinodermal armor Deus Ex.
Dude, I love this kind of shit. Yeah,
it is some crazy shit. When you mention about how like these foglets could like help you make armor or something,
mm-hmm.
So it reminded me of this. So what it is let's see. Actually, sorry, is it the rhinodermal armor? Did I get that mixed up with something else? No, sorry, my bad. It's actually called the Titan armor. But basically, what it is, okay, is in Deus Ex, the Titan armor. Yeah, Titan armor. There you go. Yeah, yeah. So go up a little bit, and then you can click that one right there, the second picture. And no, sorry. Well, basically what it is, okay, is because in this world, cybernetic enhancements is just like a pretty normal thing. There is stigma towards it, but it's gotten to the point where the imagination is really the limit to what can be created. And what the armor was, why related to the fog that you're mentioning, is because you can, in the game, you can get, it's like all these like really tiny, almost like nanomachines that are like inside of the person's skin. And then when you activate it, it comes out of your skin, all your pores and everything. And it literally forms a layer of this impenetrable armor that is able to take anything from like a rocket blast to like a 9mm, handgun shot.
Crazy.
And anything along those lines. And it's like, maybe with foglets or like nanodust or whatever,
yeah,
you might get something similar where you could just deploy it. And then it's like your own personal protective shield.
Yeah. Just
is created.
Dude, that's so sick. Yeah, it's kind of this kind of it at work right now. This dude's getting like blasted with a shotgun.
Yeah, dude.
That's super crazy. Yeah, it reminds me of kind of, I guess Dune was kind of a different version of this, not necessarily like the with the foglets, but how like everybody in Dune would have to like, if they would go into combat, they'd have like this the shield that they would turn on. I thought what was really crazy about how they represented the shield in it is that it wasn't like it was impenetrable, right? It just kind of assisted you, but it still allowed for vulnerabilities, I guess, in the user.
Yeah, and it was very interesting how they combated that, because the shield itself was how it protected you was when whatever object hits it, if it's arriving at a certain if it's faster than a certain set point, then the shield will protect you. That's why, remember when you see them fighting, is they would, when they get close to someone they want to like cut, they cut slowly, or they push the dagger into the person slowly, because that's how you go and penetrate the shield. Any fast motion, it blocks it. But the interesting thing is that in terms of like projectiles, so like if you had that and you got shot with a handgun, it would protect you from the handgun shot. But they later on had other ways to work around it, where they would shoot a projectile that once it hits the shield, it actually stayed there and it would slowly keep moving itself into the shield. And then it bypasses the protection that it provides.
Yeah, I think I saw that with like, spoiler alert, but when like the doctor, he shot like the little like poison dart.
Yeah, yeah. That's exactly it.
Dude, that movie was like fucking crazy, man. I was like, I felt like a little kid at like, I was like, oh my gosh, what the fuck? Dude, I also have a baby crush on Zendaya, bro. She's out there just like, hello.
Who didn't at one point?
Bro, yeah, dude. But absolutely. Such a great movie. One of probably my favorite movies in like the last 10 years, easily.
Yeah, agreed. Absolutely.
There was like really good storytelling too. Like I think that they like, sometimes it's like super easy to like just like, I don't know, just kind of rely on the sci-fi aspect of the movie and not really give a shit about the story. Yeah. But the story was like phenomenal.
It is. It's top tier. Cause you also get to see like cause you can see like the overarching story, and you also see the underlying story. You have to kind of read between the lines for some of the things that's happening, which I also really liked.
Exactly. And I remember trying to read the book when I was like a kid, and I was like, this is just like, it looked like this thick.
Yeah,
dude. I got through like a couple pages and I was like, what? Like, what are they talking about? Like spice? Like, I was like, what the fuck? I remember it's when I was studying art, and my art teacher, he told me about it. He hyped it up so much that I ended up buying the book, and I never like fully read it. so when the movie came out, I was like, oh sweet, like. but what I do know is that the story was like, it was so dense that movie adaptations of that book were just like, almost like a bunch of people had tried it and essentially had not come out good.
No, the
fact that they were able to execute it was like super crazy.
Oh, totally, dude. Because I never saw the older ones. Uh-huh. I only saw this one, but some people I know that have seen the old one, they're like, yeah, the new one's pretty good. Because I believe the book itself, I still have to read it too. But if I remember correctly, it literally goes through the entire life of Paul Atreides, as well as like his family.
Yeah.
Like it's not like, oh, he's a kid, and then the next chapter he's like an adult. It's like, no, they literally go through like step by step the entire life of his.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And it's like, it's pretty sophisticated. There's like I was reading on some of the plot lines from like the other books after I watched the movie, and it seems to me that there's a lot of complications in that storyline that are not necessarily straightforward. If you've ever read a story anywhere else, there's like a lot of things like I guess the division between who's the good guy and who's the bad guy is not always like super.
It's not clear.
Like it plays out more like actual like human reality, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. I like that.
Yeah, I like it too, because I think it's super easy to like, that's why I've always kind of had a thing for like anti-heroes too, is because mm-hmm. I feel like they're more like a human being, where like one, like you, every human being has something like saintly in them, but then they also have like a lot of like negativity, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, totally. Like, you know, of like D&D, right? Dungeons and Dragons.
Yeah. Or you heard of it? Of it. I've never played it.
Okay. So I only started playing it like last year. Okay. Uh-huh. I was able to find some, a good group of friends who played it. And one of the memes is that anybody who plays like a paladin, they're always trying to be like that, like, you know, that goody two shoes, like I'm holier than thou. I'm only going to do good things. You know, bad people die or whatever. I'm actually very glad that the table that I played at least didn't have anybody do that, because you're right. Like, the anti-heroes, a lot of the times they seem a lot more human than the people who are like just pure evil, or people who are like, you know, just pure good.
Yeah. Yeah, dude, it's so crazy. What I was thinking, it was crazy because I was also thinking about this, that like the reason why we're attracted to characters in general is because of their vulnerabilities, right? Like the best stories are stories related to where like the hero gets like fucked up and is like, there's a chance that like he might not make it out of the current circumstance that he's in. And a lot of times it's because he messed up somewhere. There's some imperfection that he had that led him down that path. And then when he's able to kind of like rebuild it and then get the win at the end of it, that's like a common like trajectory of a story that is very attractive to people. And I realized more and more that what actually works in terms of communication and connecting with others, even in particular with the internet, is to just being honest, you know, to just being honest with who you are, what your shortcomings are. And that way, like, you never have to feel like you have to put up an image for anybody, you know? And I think that that's like super important now that we're tying it back to the internet of things and to a topic that we were talking about earlier too, is that when you broadcast yourself across the network utilizing these devices, it's super easy to utilize these devices as a filter. And in some ways you can tailor it, your representation of you across this network in a way that you want people to perceive you as opposed to who you really are. Mm. And to me, what I've actually realized is that, these like self-taught hustle, all the stuff that I do on this channel, even in like communications like this, I'm probably the most transparent in terms of what I'm actually thinking about, what I'm actually going through. Then even like with some of the, then half of my interactions in the real world, you know, like I don't go and like tell somebody in the grocery store, hey, like today was fucking tough as fuck, you know, like I don't say that, you know, but I'll come on here and tell you guys, like you saw me mess up things like earlier, in the stream. And I think that like all that stuff is just, at the end of the day, just adds to the appeal of the channel and to the character. Cause it's like, you know, guys, like, I'm just like you, you know, I'm Dickson. I'm just like you. I'm just like anybody else in the audience right now, you know?
Yeah. And I think there's, how do I say it? There is a lot of value in doing that. And especially, I think a big part is, what if you wind up running into the people who like look at your stuff in person, you know?
Yeah.
Like, would you rather be playing a role or actually just kind of show them who you really are?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, like I think we all have like, you know, certain masks and everything. But at the same time, there's also a level of like authenticity you can go and incorporate into that, which, you know, rings true with, I think, the people that really resonate with your content. It's something that they really appreciate.
Yeah, and I think it's so crazy. And then again, tying it back to the internet of things, is that when you're connected to this network, I'm communicating to like a fucking camera right now, really. Like, my physical reality is that I'm communicating to a camera with this like mic on and all this stuff. But the thing is that people listen to this stuff and they're impacted in their real lives, you know? So like, it's not like these things happen in a silo, you know, like the communication that happens right now, the topics that we talk about, the impact that they have on people, it's real, you know, like and especially if you're listening to the information, you're paying attention to it. What I realize is that you're actually you're getting programmed by what we're saying here one way or another, even with us unintentionally wanting to do so, because that's the nature of things, right? Like if you were to hang out around like a couple of your buddies and your buddies were to talk about certain topics, you're going to get programmed on those particular topics, you know? Mm-hmm. The only difference is that you get the communication in the form of a device. Like I'm on a device and you're on a device somewhere else in the world, but because we're both connected to the same network, we're able to impact each other's existence to some degree by the things that I say and the way that you understand them and the things that you say and the way that I understand them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely, dude. Absolutely.
Yeah. So it is kind of it's kind of weird that it does exist in that paradox where it seems like we're technically more connected now, right? But at the same time, we're actually, yeah. So,
yeah,
super weird.
It is really weird, because we really do have ways to connect that people from 100 years ago would probably die. Like, could you imagine back in like the 1800s? Okay, you want to go and send like, because we live in like between you and I, we live in two different countries. So if we wanted to connect back then, we probably had to like, you know, send a little telegram or a letter, and it would take what, maybe months before you even receive it or before I even get a reply back. Whereas now it's like within seconds, you can go and interact with each other and just, you know, maybe share information or just see how someone's day was. And like, but yet since we're able to go and do that, it's almost like, I don't know. It's like we have that ability to be connected, but then we also wind up choosing not to, to some extent.
Sorry, I think I muted myself there for a second because I took my hoodie off. Oh, but no, yeah, you're absolutely right, and yeah, it is absolutely insane because we can communicate faster than we've ever been able to communicate before. But it comes to show, though, that the communication is, I think, based on what you just said, it comes to show that communication is not just a verbal phenomenon. You know, it's not just enough for me to see you. It's not just enough for me to like say something to you. It's actually important to physically be in that presence to get the full experience of what we find as humans valuable about communication. Okay. Yeah. And I think this is where it's going to get crazy too, because you were talking about something earlier, you were alluding to it earlier where you said, okay, well, it'll get to a point where you can through the internet of things, through the network that all of these devices connect us to, that we'll actually be able to experience the emotions of one another. And you say to yourself, okay, well, if it gets to a point where we can experience the emotions of one another while we're communicating, isn't that a degree more advanced than the way we're even able to communicate physically, right? Mm-hmm. Where we can only empathize with the emotions of one another. But if you can actually feel what the other person is going through at that point, has our form of communication advanced even what our physical capability currently is for that communication?
Yeah, I think it would. I think it would, dude. It also goes back to one of the first episodes we did together when we were talking about what if you could actually see somebody else's memory, see and felt what they were experiencing in that moment in time. That would completely change how we would communicate with each other at that point. Because now it's no longer you describing to me what your experience was like. Yeah. If I'm able to go and actually experience it like you experienced it, then I'd be like, yo, I know. Like me just saying like, no, I know exactly what you went through. It wouldn't be just words. It's like, no, I really did like know exactly what you went through because I got to experience it. I think that would take us to a new level.
Yeah. I think it would also be like, there'd be a lot of implications too. Like, have you ever seen Minority Report?
Oh yeah. That movie freaked me out when I was a kid, but I did remember it. Yeah.
Yeah. Minority Report's pretty crazy. And yeah, similar thing where they have like they have the ability to essentially be able to predict, crimes before they happen. Mm. And because of that, they are able to like prevent all these murders, but they talk a lot about like what the implications of that are, where like they essentially can, they can criminalize somebody even before they actually do the crime, but because they know that that crime was supposed to happen, they justify it being able to actually like arrest that person. And to kind of twist that a little bit to what we're talking about, I could also see that tool be utilized in terms of of crimes that happen. If you could say, okay, well, we're going to try to get to the bottom of this and figure out what really happened, then you identify the people that were involved or suspects that were involved with the crime, that could have been involved with the crime, and you go and you experience what they saw in those given moments, and you'd probably be able to get a more accurate measure of what the truth was and what happened.
Yeah. And actually, back to when we were talking about the Internet of Things, I'm gonna send you something over here right now. So this is actually an anime series called
Psychopaths.
Psychopaths. And it does tie into the Internet of Things, as well as, like, you know, our talks about the future and the implications of what advanced technology can go and do. What it is, so a little bit about Psychopaths is it takes place in a futuristic Japan where they're now able to quantify the human psyche. So what that means is they have all these sensors, okay, across the entire city, that just like the Internet of Things, they're all connected, and they're able to go and read a person's psychological makeup. And very similar to Minority Report, they're able to gauge what their their psychological state is, and see and predict what is the likelihood of them doing some sort of crime. And when you get past a certain point, they actually flag you, and you are forced to go and get, like, mental health, like therapy or whatever. Otherwise, they wind up basically branding you in a way that you just can't function properly in society anymore. But then they start talking about the society as if everything is perfect. But obviously with cyberpunk, nothing's ever perfect, because in this world, they talk about how that system that is able to quantify people's psyche as being perfect, that whatever it tells you to go and do, you should go and do it. But then eventually one of the characters starts figuring out that, like, they start actually encountering this one criminal that cannot be quantified by the system. Even though the system was supposed to be perfect, they were raised to believe that it was perfect. But if the system can't even quantify that, like, what this person's psychological makeup is when they're committing these terrible crimes, is it, like, a perfect system? And then it just goes down this huge, like, rabbit hole from there. But
crazy.
But back to, like, the Internet of Things, is that when we start having this expansion of, more interconnected devices and all of the different sensory data that it's able to go and pull, something like that might actually wind up being created. Okay, it might not be them, viewing your psychological state, but in terms of, like, surveillance, they probably could put surveillance devices anywhere that they want in the city now, no longer restricted by whether or not they get some sort of cable, electrical cable, or, like, solar panels or something.
Yeah. I mean, that's super crazy. Yeah, I think that's such a good point. And because I was also thinking about it, because I was like, as you were talking, I was like, okay, so if we're able to essentially have so many devices to the point where the connectivity is so high that you can experience another person's psychology and stuff like their emotions, then wouldn't we be less likely to opt in for, like, stuff like conflict, you know? Because we would probably at that point be like, oh shit, like, I can effectively feel exactly what this dude is feeling or feel what that person is feeling. And essentially the solution that it would actually enable you to do is to actually literally be able to walk in that person's shoes for, like, a day, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that at that point, that would be very, very crazy, because I think most of us, if we were to, like, it's really easy. It's very, very easy. And I catch myself doing this sometimes, where I walk around society and it's very easy for me to, like, if I'm doing well or if I'm working really hard on something, to essentially cast judgment on other people. Like, I've done that before in my life, you know?
Yeah, same.
And what I was going to say is that a lot of times that actually comes from, like, an insecure place, you know? It's me fearing going back to being just kind of flaccid about existence, you know? And I have to, like, talk down to that type of, to people that are in that situation, because it, I feel like it gives me like a layer of separation, but really it's an insecurity that I don't want to go back there. Right. Mm-hmm. And then what I realized is that, okay, you know what, man, like, holy shit. Like, how fucking crazy would it be for me to like, actually like, and I wouldn't want this, honestly, I would not want this whatsoever. But to actually have to fill in the shoes of like a an actual homeless person, you know?
Yeah.
And like, I'm not casting a moral judgment on why they're in that situation or not. But what I'm saying, however, what I'm saying is that, gosh, would it be interesting to know if the technology allows us to do that, what would happen if I actually, from my perspective in my current stance in life, were to have to experience that person's life for one day, how fucking different I would view my life, you know? And really, no, I'm not casting a moral judgment on that. I just think it would be a very interesting experience, and not one that I would want, really, you know?
Yeah.
And I think that when you, if the technology were to enable us to do that, it would be a lot harder to self-contain our beliefs, to self-validate our beliefs in life that they're the most true, you know? Because once you are able to not just understand the perspective that somebody's coming from, right, but actually fit in those shoes, you might be like, fuck, maybe it's not what I thought it was.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right with that, because the level of understanding we would then start to have with each other would just exponentially increase at that point. Because I think a big part of it is that we just don't sometimes, like, when we do certain things that rub people the wrong way, not that you want to go and, like, you know, please everybody, but I'm just saying that some people are just, like, completely rude, okay? And you're just wondering, like, oh, like why they were rude to a certain person, or, like, why racism is such a thing. It's like, what if you're able to go and actually get people to experience what it's like being on the other side, and then let them to actually experience what it's like for that to happen to them, then we might actually start having a more, I'd say, a world where people actually can start to understand each other a lot better.
Yeah, exactly. 100%. Shout out to Black Sheep, one of the earliest support, the earliest supporter of the channel. So really appreciate you being here, man. You're absolutely right. And I think, it's some of this, like, it makes me realize too that I think there are ways that you can incentivize better interactions with humans. For example, like, when I think of, like, when I think of Bitcoin and it being a potentially being like a standard, like a monetary standard, that in and of itself, that's a network too, you know, and you connect with you have devices that connect with that network, you know?
Right.
And I think that essentially it's a network that exchanges monetary value and that nobody has control over. And I think that, here's something crazy that I was thinking about recently, and kind of trying to tie this as much as I can to the Internet of Things, where I was like, okay, well, if we ever change the monetary standard that we're on to something that is that's me being generous, to an actually superior monetary standard than the one that exists today. Mm-hmm. Then what would be so crazy is that the value exchange at that point would have to be so high, because you would essentially have to provide something of such high value and such sincere, true value that somebody would be willing to part with Satoshis for it, you know, or a full Bitcoin. And I think that that's so crazy, because you say, okay, well, that's going to force market participants to essentially say, okay, the only way that I'm actually going to be able to get Bitcoin in the future is if I earn it. And to earn it, I have to produce something of such high value effectively that somebody is going to be willing to depart with their Bitcoin because of it, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think it's going to force this, like, honesty in the market of of essentially the people that participate in it to produce higher quality stuff, better quality stuff that's more honestly, that's honest in its origins. Because I think that's one of the things that in the current standard is just completely just, it's just garbage, because it's so hard to distinguish between who's trying to rug you and then like somebody who's like genuinely trying to produce a market-based solution, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely, man.
And the reason why I say that is because if you have a sounder standard underlying the interactions within the market, then the participants in that market are going to be for one way or another, be incentivized to have to interact for the benefit of one another, you know? And I think that even if we can't get the emotional, the capacity to experience each other's emotional kind of experiences or the emotional perspective, at least having a standard in existing in a network, right, that that enables us to, that incentivizes us to benefit one another, that'll at very least help with that, you know?
Mm-hmm. 'Cause at that point, it really incentivizes higher quality things to be produced.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Because you're not going to want to part with your corn, right? You're not going to want to part with your Satoshis if the thing that you're exchanging those Satoshis for in whatever shape or form is suspect of being bullshit.
Yeah. Know?
Yeah. So you're going to have a higher degree. There's going to have to be a higher degree of being able to demonstrate that what you're providing to the market is of high value. And in fact, it will filter the market solutions to only the ones that actually provide solutions to the market. And right. I think that's going to be extremely important and something that allows us to, we're able to participate in that market now currently today because of the devices that we have, you know, and devices that are involved in a network that's bigger than any one individual that's involved in that given network. Right.
Yeah. Like the technology that allows this network to even happen, you know, we wouldn't even be talking about this if that wasn't even around in the first place.
Yeah, exactly. And maybe there'll be some sort of fucking nexus to it, man, because I think imagine if you actually had to experience like somebody who's like in a really shitty situation, right? Like I'm thinking about right now, like companies where like where their currencies have inflated to the point where they can't buy food or they can't like they're like in like legit survival mode. Like if any one of us in the first world would have to experience that degree of desperation, I think we would be forever changed. I don't think that there wouldn't be somebody who would come back and take Amazon Amazon Prime for granted or Uber Eats for granted, you know? There would be no way. And I think that would be really crazy because if we could experience what those people go through, then we would be more incentivized to then provide actual real solutions, you know? Yeah. Because you can't feel for somebody like that and not want to do something about it, you know? Mm-hmm. It's kind of inhuman.
Yeah. Yeah, it really is. I mean, or psychopathic is the other thing.
Or psychopathic, yeah, that's very true, and that's actually a very good delineation there. And just to say that, I don't think what I'm not trying to do is to cast any morality over it or be like, I'm better for thinking about it. Like that's not the case at all. Like it's something that I've thought about as an observation, you know.
Yeah, and I think something like that will happen in the coming decades. Because remember, when we're able to start actually like transferring something as simple as like the smell of something over the internet, okay, and then you're able to receive it,
I'm gonna send you my farts, Dickson.
Not if I send it to you first. Just wake up one.
Yeah,
wake
up I was one gonna day. Say waking up. Yeah,
yeah. You wake up one day, check your phone. It's like, oh my god, what is that?
Just after breakfast, please.
Right? Isn't that hilarious, though? Like, we talk about sending something like, you know, smells and whatever, and we're like, first thing comes to our minds, we're going to send a fart over to our friends.
Dude, it's like the thing with like the phones, like they could do all this shit, but you know, most people don't do all this techie stuff with their phones, bro. Like IG, give me TikTok. Like we use phones for like the dumbest fucking shit, but go ahead. Right? Sorry.
Well, no, it's all good, man.
Just human nature.
It is human nature. Yeah, it is human nature. But I just wanted to say that I think we will get to a point where we actually can live through another reality in a way, mm-hmm. through like VR and also the different technologies, and literally experience or at least gain knowledge in a way that we never were able to do before. Like, remember, you've ever played Metal Gear Solid?
Yeah.
Played that? Mm-hmm. So, do you remember when, I think his name was like Raiden, when Raiden was there?
It wasn't the white-haired one?
Yeah, the white-haired one. And then one of the things that they always kind of like, in the story, they bugged him about was, he's like, oh yeah, I have like X many hours in VR training. And then Snake just bugs him about it because uh-huh. all that was in VR. But something like that, I think, will happen, is that we will have the ability to go and actually learn and pick up skills in like a virtual reality environment, similar to like I remember hearing about how some people who are able to go and lucid dream, they would actually use that to go and learn new skills at times. But virtual reality would be something that's a lot more, I think, accessible, that allows people to go and literally go and learn real world skills, but in a virtual environment. And the crazy thing is that when you could actually transfer it from virtual reality to the physical environment, even though technically you never did it in the physical environment in the first place, you just did it all in VR, but you're able to now do it properly in the real world. I think something like that will happen, which then will also evolve to us being able to experience what life in somebody else's shoes will be, if we choose to. I mean, who knows? You like maybe
it'd be like I was reminded of like Neo when he gets uploaded with the kung fu.
Yeah, dude.
Yeah, Tech Chief was talking about it last time.
Yeah, like how he gets that downloaded. I was thinking another thing would be like let's say maybe for certain prisons. Okay, I don't know where, but this is just a hypothetical idea. But like, if they were to say want to rehabilitate certain people in the prison system, okay, one way maybe through virtual reality, how to kind of like ease them back in society in a way, mm-hmm. and where they just treat it like. In a way, it's almost like a game, but then it has real world consequences. We're able to go and actually, hopefully, teach them something, or at least hopefully, ease that transition back into society rather than keep them in that constant loop. But I mean, that's a whole other issue, because like, I think we all kind of know, like, prisons make big money, and they make a lot of money just by keeping people in there and perpetuating that too.
Yeah, and I was going to say that it really, like, the incentive structures that underline the system in which these technologies will exist, I think, is going to affect a lot of the way that they're implemented,
Yeah.
We're likely going to have to, in order for the technologies to be of greater benefit than of a drawback, we're going to have to be in a freer incentive structure somehow, some way, where you can't have central parties essentially dictating the direction of these technologies to it has to be as open source as possible, I think, for it to be in the probably most likely in the best benefit of the greater whole, I would say, right? Mm-hmm. Because I think you see a lot of examples of technologies or advancements in these networks and stuff like and stuff with like in our age, a good example is like social media, where you have centrality in the development of these essentially these pockets of the network, And you're creating a governance system at the top of the application that all these different nodes in a network interact with. So despite the fact that you're able to connect at higher speeds and you're able to exchange all these informations, you're contained within the framework of the governing entity that sustains the network, the section of that network, right? Mm-hmm. So I think the more open you're able to have these advancements, the less likely you're going to have somebody essentially, kind of corrupt them effectively,
Yeah.
For better or for worse. I mean, and to be quite honest, it's not clear to me that things being open source always lead to higher degrees of innovation quite yet. Although that's probably a very ignorant statement. What do you think about that?
I think that there's a higher likelihood that it would, just because it's open source, right? It's not like some sort of proprietary locked away technology that it's very hard to have access to. If you open source it, I think it would lead to a higher probability that something like that would happen. Just because it's, for one thing, it's easier for people to have access to actually play around with it, to go and hack it and see what it could do and play around with it.
Yeah. And it seems to me that innovation can you get efficiencies in technology when you centralize the development of that technology within a given group. So perhaps you're going to have a better product, if you would, when everything is said and done, because you're kind of able to account for all the, you're able to account for more of the parameters that make that product good to the marketplace. First and foremost. But the problem is that you put the technology in a box at that point, right? And there are, it's under the dictate of the owner, the people that are developing that technology. So I don't know, there's a trade-off there. I think maybe you get more innovation in a closed environment, but you, and this is me talking out of my ass. I don't have any data to back this up, but you might get more innovation in a closed environment, but you in some sense, it's probably, how do I say this? It's probably, I don't know. You're just playing in somebody else's backyard, really. When everything comes down, if you're a user in that environment, you're playing in somebody else's backyard. You know,
I think though, not unless like you actually. So actually, here's what I was thinking when you're mentioning that is, I think even though like anything that's open sourced, if I might be wrong about this, okay, but I think that anything that's open source technically was centralized at one point, because it had to be in order for it to be created. But then it was like, once it's been created, now it's the passing of the torch over to anybody else who wants to go and play around with it. Like, for example, like Bitcoin, okay? Bitcoin, we know that it was Satoshi that created it. Now, whether they were like one person or they were a group of people, to this day, we still have no idea. But it was created by them first, but then they like released it out now. Now it's decentralized. Like nobody's able to go and actually like, you know, find them. And Bitcoin took on a life of its own. Mm-hmm. But I think everything starts off centralized first before it kind of moves on to that next step of being decentralized. But it's being moved onto that next point, which is really important, because there are a lot of things that are created centrally that unfortunately don't get decentralized because of many reasons. Okay.
Yeah. No, I think you make a good point that where the inception point is, even for a decentralized system, the inception point is going to be a central, it's going to be a central inception point. That's a good point. I think decentralized systems almost seem like they are harder to make, it's harder to actually make them work, you know, like, because if you're able to hook everything up in like, say, like your typical application, everything is hosted on one fucking server, right?
Yeah.
So it's actually just easier to go down that route, right, rather than depend on essentially what equates to a decentralized back end. So I think that there's a higher degree of complexity to be able to innovate on a decentralized system, but effectively the best innovations will come out of that space, because culturally that's where we're trending toward that direction. You know, I think that we've gone through a lot of eras, like our eras in our time, have been centrally governed. So I think that we're moving toward systems, and our technology is reflecting that either do implement some form of decentralized network, or we love the idea so much of that we even fall for fugazi systems that use the buzzword of decentralization as a catch for us, right? In fact, we want to give our attention to decentralized systems so much that we'll unknowingly get played and be like, okay, well, I'm going to get involved with this protocol, because they say that they're decentralized, and turns out, oh no, they're not. It's actually a fucking Ponzi scheme, right?
Yeah.
So, well, there's that.
Well, yeah, I think there's that, like that want of something that's decentralized, just, you know, because we probably all had some experiences of how, what a shitty experience we had with some centralized like entities, protocols,
And not just crypto, like typical, like crypto, your social media websites, stuff like everything from like Web2, stuff like that. Like,
yeah, like it's not just crypto. Yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, it's just like, I'll tell you something that just happened recently. So in the last 2 days, have you ever heard of the telecommunications company called Rogers?
Rogers, no.
Okay, so it's up in Canada. Rogers is one of the main telecommunications companies, and I didn't know this, but it seems like they run the Interact system that we have here, the Interact system, like the debit card system. And why I say that is because there's some system issue that made it so that it went down the whole day yesterday, across like nobody could use debit cards anywhere.
Whoa.
And I was like, what? That's so wild. That and it was all centralized into like one entity there. Mm-hmm. And when something went wrong, now it's all done. So
yeah, single point of failure.
Yeah, exactly. Single point of failure. So like who knows what's gonna come out of like a potential investigation as to why that happened. But it's just like something like that. Because
yeah.
One of my friends like wasn't able to use his phone, but I mean some businesses rely on their services to like literally do business, and they can't do it now. And so that's a really shitty experience.
Yeah. Yeah. That's crazy. Yeah. Reliability. Yeah. Because whenever whoever is, you know, essentially responsible for being able to set up that network or that system in the first place, if they don't show up one of those days, then everybody who depends on that given system is kind of fucked, you know?
Yeah.
So yeah, exactly. So yeah, I get that. That's another, I guess, yeah, that is another benefit of decentralization, is that you don't have to, there's not really a single point of failure with it. True decentralization. Yeah. So yeah, actually, man.
One thing I want to ask you was like, do you think it's, if it's decentralized, okay, do you think that itself would make it so that there's no single point of failures, or do you think it would come down to just creating a system that is trustless in the first place, regardless if it's centralized or decentralized?
The trustlessness is kind of the ethos of it, that you don't have to. I don't have to depend on whether or not Dickson wakes up today and is pissed at me or is happy. You know, you don't have to depend on me being happy or pissed in order for your transaction to happen. You know, it works regardless of the human inputs to the network. And I think that's the thing. That's probably the solution that it provides, because it's almost like in every other solution, you can't take the human element out of it. And because you can't take the human element out of it, the likelihood of it being corrupted is likely only because it involves humans. Not because I think that there's anybody, I mean, there, I think that there's like inherent evil out there, but I would say that given most people will do some bad shit throughout their lifetime, one way or another, you know. Mm-hmm. I highly doubt anybody lives a saint like saint like lifestyle where they don't fuck things up, you know, at some point or another. So so if you base a system on the probability of somebody doing a corruptive act, the likelihood of that probability actually playing out in that system is nearly imminent, you know.
So
I think that the trust thing that you mentioned is just so huge. When you take when you don't have to trust that person is going to have to show up, and it's going to be there, that reliability is going to be there, that just has a tremendous, that like that's a huge solution. That is just a super huge solution. Especially if there's two market actors. Like if I don't have to ever worry about like whether or not like the payment rail for me to exchange value between me and you is going to be up, and I just I'm confident that I could do that anywhere in the world. I don't have to go to a bank to do it. I just can just transfer economic value to you. Mm-hmm. Based on some service or good that you gave me. That also just makes that process so much more fluid. You know, you're gonna have more people wanting to. In that structure, the incentive to go to the market would be a lot higher too, because you're going to say, okay, like I don't have to worry about like I have to fill out like 1,000 different papers and all this stuff, mm-hmm. like all this administrative like just red tape in order for me to be able to transact in the market. I could go straight to the market and provide value to it and get value back, you know. Mm-hmm. And it's with these devices that I have in me that I'm able to transact. It's just like that trustlessness just it just creates a fluidity to interaction, you know? And yes. And I think that, dude, I think that so much of what prevents people from getting involved in a market as entrepreneurs is that there's just so much administrative overhead to all of your behaviors and actions in the market that you're just get weighed down by having to account for all of it, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Because I mean, let's say like entrepreneurs, okay? Mm-hmm. A lot of times they're entrepreneurs for a reason. They're not administrative, like that. They're not focused only on administration, okay? Like entrepreneurship, they're just focused on how do they go and create value and then bring it to market.
Yeah, exactly.
And then make a profit from it. They're not there sitting down like, okay, what's all the regulations here? Like, what are all the forms I got to fill out? Or like, obviously you would need to know that. Like that is kind of part of your responsibility. But I mean, hopefully at one point you'll be able to, you know, at least get some help so that you have someone who is focused only on that. Then as an entrepreneur, you can go and focus on what you're actually good at, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Dude,
that's all I want to say. Yeah.
Oh, I was gonna add on to that. I've been doing some research, and so like people talk about this where it's like, okay, you can't just be an engineer. Like you have to be an engineer who's also focused on understanding how to invest properly because of the current system that you exist in, right? Where all of the work that you do is essentially it's devaluing. So you work super, super hard and then you earn cash, right? Or the equivalent of cash, and that cash loses its value. So then you're incentivized to work harder for money that's losing value. And because it's losing value, then you're forced to actually adopt an investment strategy that essentially either preserves or increases the value of that money. So nobody can just be specific to their skill. It's not like I could go earn money, right? That is just going to sustain its value, right? Okay, well, Bitcoin provides a solution to that, but typically you couldn't do that. So you would have to focus on the typical game is to, okay, well, where am I going to park this money? Am I going to invest in real estate? Am I going to look at what kind of assets am I going to look at? Am I going to look at a commodity, investing in commodities? Maybe I like bonds, you know? So one of the things that I thought was really interesting is that actually having to focus on that kind of stuff actually detracts from you becoming more specialized in your skill set, because you can't just be an engineer. You have to be an engineer / investor, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
But, and if you have a sound money that doesn't lose its value, then everybody could just play the simplest fucking game to play for longevity and wealth. Save. I get to, I earn my money and then I save it.
Yeah.
And then in 100 years or 75 years or whatever, either that money has accrued in value or it's sustained its value.
Yeah.
And then it's just, you don't have to go get into all these like real vision and like investment strategies, you know, where like you have like these people just throwing out all these like just aggressively intense word salads of their understanding of a fucking bipolar market, you know? Mm-hmm. It's like ridiculous. And I thought about that. I was like, yeah, that'd be so crazy if we could all just actually specialize in our skill set. And with the money that we earn from that skill set, we don't have to worry about, okay, where am I going to park it? Where am I going to put it? What's the next big move that I'm going to do? Instead of just focus, oh, I could actually just save this. And it's going to retain like all of that work that I put in. It's going to, the value of that work that I put out into the market, it's going to be here 10 years from now, 20 years from now. Like, it just creates for a much sounder society because you start to also start thinking long-term, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. No longer like paycheck to paycheck.
Yeah, exactly. And it's when you switch to that long-term mentality that you're able to kind of take the world in this more observational manner, and your decision-making stops becoming so like anxiety driven, you know, so immediate gratification seeking. And you kind of have to be when your money's losing its value, because whatever you're going to earn is going to lose value. So you have to be like on your toes to be like, okay, where am I going to put it? We're going to, you're almost like this, like this anxious, like market actor, as opposed to like getting the money, being like, all right, I know that I just secured I just incremented the longevity of my wealth, you know?
Yeah. It's literally like the difference between acting because of fear or because of, I'd say, a place of contentment.
Yeah, of abundance. Yeah, of financial abundance. Because when you have that backing, you have that security. That hey, look, what I'm earning is going to be there for me when everything is said and done. You're just you cease to have to worry about the day to day as much, you know?
Yeah.
And you're able to focus on these more existential and equally important things that I think make us the quality of your thoughts increase, you know? You're not, when you interact with people, you're not like this anxious mess that is like just trying to pay rent at the end of the month, you know?
Yeah.
And that makes tons and tons of differences, because when you switch that longevity mindset, you start to also think about the importance of having things like a family.
Yeah.
You know? So I think that changing that underlying system does affect a lot of our human behavior.
Yeah, totally. Because now you're no longer short term and just focusing on like, I mean, there is obviously benefits to focusing on like the here and now, mm-hmm. but you also want to be able to look into the future as well, right? Because we're not living in like the African savanna anymore. Living a hand to mouth kind of existence. Like now we do have the ability to kind of plan things out if we want to. And unfortunately, especially with money, we can sometimes fall back into that anxious loop where we're just, you know, just living day by day.
Yeah.
Just existing.
And I think that's why you see it reflected in the culture. I mean, I'm sure you see it in Canada too, where there's almost like an increased desperation in the population as a whole. And that's because they're losing value and they're losing monetary value. And they most people probably find it a bit senseless, whether they know this overtly or subconsciously. Most people find it senseless to go and just be working for like $13 or $14 an hour, just to realize that, okay, well, that $13, $14 an hour really doesn't mean shit anymore, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's like, okay. And then on top of that, then I'm going to get slammed with like taxes at the end of the year. And they're like, okay, well, fuck that. I'm just going to opt out. And that's what's happening, you know? And I just see the increase in desperation everywhere, man. Like you could just, it's palpable. It like people are, they're almost like it's in their energy, you know, the way that they interact with on a day-to-day basis. And what also happens is that when that desperation increases, the likelihood of people doing desperate acts also increases, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
So that's why you get a lot of like the crazy, like just random violent acts of violence that you see, you know. And I think people all around us are starting to notice that something is fucked up, you know.
Yeah.
And yeah, I mean, I think the best thing about this is that if as things progressively become more obviously wrong, and people are the suffering becomes more and more prevalent, and people are starting to feel it, that's when shit's going to change. That's when all of this, like the innovations are going to increase, because there's going to be a necessity to solve real problems. You know, you can't stick your head in the sand any longer at that point effectively. And that's where I realized, I was like, that's so much of why things like the conformity that we've gained living in the United States or even in Canada is that we've never had to really face the pain and the struggle that actually comes with things. Like we may have had to kind of run around to pay our rent, but not a lot of people have had to face things like, oh shit, like there's no more food in the supermarket, stuff mm-hmm. like that. And when I think when people hit, even start to graze on the reality of stuff like that starting to happen to them, there's just the mindset switches from conformity to holy shit, something has to get solved, because this is a real problem now. You know, you can't Netflix and chill it away anymore. You know,
no, you just can't ignore it. Like there's no way to ignore it anymore when it's right up in your face.
Yeah, exactly. And I think that the intensity of that has increased, and it's going to be key, because all of that pressure is also, to tie this all back to this particular chat, is that that pressure is also going to increase the innovations that happen, you know, because we're going to have to solve more and more problems in order for us to get out of this rut. We're going to have to innovate new solutions to the current problems that we have. And that's why I was telling you that I think that there's probably going to be some point where there's going to be a greater physical connection between people, because I kind of see like people have kind of had it, you know?
Yeah.
So we'll see, man. It's going to be, we are probably in our generations, dude, we get to experience probably just the change, like global changes that generations before us, I would say probably the three generations before us had it way more stable than we're getting it and then we're going to get it. But one of the benefits of that is that we get to see the inception of something new, something beautiful.
Yeah. And I think that's just one thing that's very key to like our generation. I mean, like not to say that we're like, you know, so special and everything, but I mean, we kind of are at the same time, because we got to see, like you said, at the very beginning, that bridge from
the tail end. Yeah.
From the tail end of the old world into the new one. And then for those of us who are, you know, still paying attention to this, we get to see the newer technology that then comes out too. Whereas like for some of the older generation, it might be very foreign to them. Whereas for us, it's like, oh, you know what? This is no different than what we had to go through like 10 years ago.
Where we
had to deal with the new stuff that was coming out.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It kind of feels like you're like, you're not the wave. It's not like it's coming or or it's past. It's like you're riding the wave, you know, you're like right in the middle of it. And I feel it even more. I think a lot of us, a lot of the millennials feel it acutely because we're coming of age in this era, you know, like it's like the first time where like you look around, and you're like, oh, I'm the only dude holding the torch anymore around me. You know, that's why it becomes like almost this like holy shit, like this like rush of intensity, because you start to realize, I'm like, holy fuck, I'm coming of age in one of the craziest fucking times to come of age, where the three generations before me just had it much more like, get a corporate job, Stevie, you know, like all that bullshit, all that's gone out the window, you know. And now you're just like, you're kind of like, we're right on the bleeding edge of all of this change. That's why all the innovations, like the changes that are happening with technology, you're seeing it. You're also seeing like the world change, and you're just like, what the fuck, dude? Like, holy shit. Like, you can't write this stuff. You can't.
You can't. And we literally have front row seats to the future.
Yeah. It's like they fucking put us on a roller coaster, right? Life put us on a roller coaster.
Yeah.
And we took the seats in the front. You know what I'm saying? So you're just like,
you can't get off this ride.
No, you can't get off the ride. You have to ride it out, dude. And it's already, I've realized even in me, it's already created a lot of like adaptive behaviors that before I would have taken for granted. I think it's going to push a lot of people to become involved in the market in a really interesting way that they haven't before, because I think that the traditional walked paths, you know, the beaten paths, those are gone. So the people that are going to be successful are people that are going to be able to think outside of the box. That's the only avenue that I see left, where it's like, think outside of the box and build your own solution, because all of the shit around you is pretty much done, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. Everything else is like expiring, and we need something new to kind of
take. Yeah, exactly. And that's why the book, we'll have to read The Fourth Turning for this series.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, but they talk about how like our generation is the hero generation, because we're like smack in the middle of it. And we're like, I could see it forcing us to start to think more critically of the environment around us and make us want to be like, okay, like, how can we solve this? Like, what can we do? You know, because I think collectively we see that there's higher potential for humans as a whole, you know, that we don't have to be bound to the negativity of our past, and that we can exist in a better future than the present that we exist in now, you know. And I think collectively as a generation, we realize that humans, for all of their imperfections, are not actually like a disease onto the earth. We're not a disease onto the earth, you know. Like, we're like, we can actually do these beautiful things. We can contribute to these, like, we can collaborate in all these awesome ways. We could connect in all these great ways. And I think that part of what's been so, I think a lot of our generation, and I'm not speaking for everybody, but I've noticed it, is that we're just tired of that, you know, of that degree of division. And it's just like, it's like everybody's stuck in second gear when you know that we have fucking four or five other gears that we could go in and go and get, you know?
Yeah.
And if we're in those gears, that's when the innovation just starts pumping, you know? That's when all the like cool shit starts happening, because people are just like, boom, boom, boom. Just like they're connecting. The ideas are flowing. We're able to transact very fast, you know?
Yeah. And I think going to create things that never existed in the first place.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, I think I killed all of the live viewers. I killed all the live viewers on my rant. Thanks, guys.
No, it's all good, man.
Oh, God.
It was a good rant. We needed it.
Thanks for riding along, Dickson. I really appreciate it, man. Oh,
no problem, man. I mean, the other thing is I can't be the one to always go on a rant either, you know?
Like, yeah. No,
you didn't have that give and take.
Dude, no, you absolutely kill it, bro. Are you cool to chop it here?
Yeah, let's chop it here and then we can, move on to the next topic next time.
Yeah, for sure. Certainly. So just going to do a quick promo. Guys, I do have a course coming out at the end of the month, July 29th, Breaking Out of Tutorial Hell. But if you need help right now and you want to get a strategy that can help you how to break out of tutorial hell, I am offering it to you here for free. All you have to do is sign up here and you will get the strategy in your email. You will also be notified of when enrollment begins for Breaking Out of Tutorial Hell. It's a educational experience, a digital course, and a lot of actually tutoring from me. So go ahead, and if you want to get on the wait list for that, and as well get your problem for Breaking Out of Tutorial Hell solved with a practical strategy, go ahead and enter your email here. Here is the last little infographic that I'll show you guys, July 29th. Breaking Out a Tutorial Hell. Be on the lookout for that. Once you sign up, you will get all the notifications for how to enroll. And I will be giving you guys more details throughout the month. So be looking forward to that. And then Dickson, do you want to give a shout out to yourself, man?
Yeah. So if you guys like what Fido and I have been talking about, you like some of the stuff that, I've been talking about, just go and follow me at Vibing with the Future. That's a new podcast that I am starting up. And we'll be releasing stuff like this, hopefully on a more regular basis soon. So just follow us there and you'll get all the details when you subscribe.
Yeah, excellent. Yeah, please do go and support Dixon's channel. I know that Dickson is like super cool. He's going to be able to go in a lot more depth, I think, when I'm not asking him questions. I mean, Dickson, you go in a lot of depth, though. But look forward to his channel. I love working with him. And I just wanted to say that it's just such a blessing to be able to continue to output content to you guys. I know that you guys connect with me in a really deep level. And just to give you an example, the most popular videos on the channel have like 50 views, but I only have 90 subscribers, guys. So I have over 50% of my subscribers likely are looking at these videos on a regular basis, for the good ones at least. But what I wanted to say, or the most popular ones, but I wanted to say that it's just I'm completely taken back by the amount of community that's been developing around this channel. And I think that everybody who's involved right now in these really early stages of the channel, when we look back, it's going to be crazy to think about just how humble our beginnings have been. And I just hope to continue to be able to reflect that hustle and that grind mentality with you guys and to show you that it's possible and that I'm just a fucking human being like you. So I appreciate you, and I will see you guys on the next time.